September 11th Commission members Bob Carey and John Lehman testified on the recommendations in their final report. This part of today's House hearing is just over 3 hours.
All right. Good morning. The committee will come to order. I want to thank everybody for coming. We're here today, nearly 3 years removed from that terrible day in September 11th, to simultaneously look back and look forward. We grieve again for the men and women who lost their lives and pray once more for their loved ones. But it's also a time to remind ourselves of the important challenges ahead, the tasks of securing our nation and eradicating terrorist networks around the globe. I want to commend the work of the National Commission on Terrorist Attacks on the United States, also known as the 9/11 Commission, for its hard work and dedication in issuing its report on the 2001 terrorist attacks, once again bringing reforms to the federal government and that structure to the forefront of the Homeland Security discussion. Yesterday, the President endorsed the creation of a presidentially appointed Senate-confirmed National Intelligence Director, as well as the creation of a National Counterterrorism Center to coordinate and monitor counterterrorism efforts. The President's call to action demonstrated that the Administration, like Congress, is working overtime to move forward with the 9/11 Commission's recommendations. The key to success in implementing the Commission's recommendations is making sure we're not simply repackaging what we have now. We need to avoid creating another layer of bureaucracy. We need to align authority with responsibility to make sure information is reaching all the people that it needs to reach. While the creation of a National Intelligence Director and a National Counterterrorism Center are the most highly publicized aspects of the Commission's recommendations, this committee will be focusing on the broad range of recommendations made by the 9/11 Commission. The National Intelligence Director will be subject of considerable debate in the coming weeks and months, but the Commission's recommendations regarding border security, information sharing databases, emergency preparedness, Homeland Security funding, and intergovernmental coordination are at least as important, if not more so, than the higher profile recommendations. We have before us today a diverse group of panelists, from commissioners and family members of victims of the World Trade Center and Pentagon attacks, to federal officials, public policy experts, and industry representatives. The collective expertise of these witnesses, along with the expertise and experience that exists among members of this committee, will no doubt lead to an interesting and fruitful discussion on the future security of our nation. We need to hear from our witnesses which recommendations they view as most urgent, which they see as important but dependent on other acts or events, and which they think will require sustained effort over time to achieve. We need to discuss what's achievable administratively and what needs congressional action. The Commission's report and the focus of this hearing are especially timely given the recent elevation of the threat advisory levels for the financial sectors of New York, Newark, and Washington, D.C. The news articles about the intelligence information that led to the elevation suggest the decision was the result of shared information between the CIA, the FBI, the National Security Agency, DIA, and other senior military officials. Even if the intelligence information at the threat elevation was based on was dated, this type of coordination is critical to the future security of our homeland, and the purpose of today's hearing is to discuss whether or not it's possible to institutionalize this type of interagency coordination. As we move forward today, next week, next month, next year, we should be encouraged that Congress, frequently through this committee's oversight, has already laid a sound foundation on which we must build. Even before 9/11, the committee held hearings on impediments to information sharing and analysis. As part of the Homeland Security Act, we passed legislation aimed at encouraging the critical infrastructure industry to share information about vulnerabilities with each other and with the government. Beginning anew today, we need to examine what's preventing better and more accurate sharing and analysis between federal agencies, between federal, state, and local governments, and between the private and the public sectors. How can we overcome those impediments? Is the voluntary information sharing mechanism between the private sector and the government that we established in 2002 working as we envisioned? Unlike much of the debate and press coverage in committee hearings, we need to be talking about more than just intelligence information per se. It's not just quote unquote intelligence information that impacts our ability to prepare for and respond to terrorist attacks. The realm of information that's not being adequately shared is not merely the province of the CIA or the FBI or NSA, nor is it encompassed by the public sector alone. What about information on public health coordination between federal, state, and local providers? What about the fact that the private sector owns and operates 85% of the nation's critical infrastructure? This committee has also been looking long and hard at government organization challenges. Part and parcel of moving from a system of need to know to need to share is the need to restructure the executive branch to match the 21st century needs and requirements. The Commission rightly recognized that we need a government better organized than the one that exists today, with its national security institution designed half a century ago to win the Cold War. I believe the Commission's report makes the need for reauthorization of executive reorganization authority all the more urgent. The obsolete, redundant, and duplicative nature of the federal bureaucracy is the single greatest impediment to moving from a system of need to know to need to share. An editorial in last week's Federal Times framed the issue well. It said, take any mission, say counterterrorism intelligence gathering and analysis, and divvy it up among a dozen or so agencies. Then let those agencies set their own goals and priorities, follow their own standards and practices, and decide their own resources and budgets. What you end up with is a design for failure. That's what exists now in government, not only with counterterrorism, but with many missions: job training, combating homelessness, environmental care, food safety, inspection, to name a few. To take on a mission successfully, there must be a cohesive strategy, coordination in planning and practices, effective sharing of information, common priorities in budgeting, and clear direction by a competent, accountable leader. That's why 18 months ago, the Volcker Commission called for all the government to be reorganized around distinct mission areas. As the 9/11 Commission points out, this lack of leadership and cohesive management also plagues one of the government's most pressing missions now, counterterrorism. The problem of government ineffectiveness in counterterrorism and other important missions is not a lack of solutions. The solutions to effective government are obvious and articulated compellingly by both the 9/11 and the Volcker Commissions. Let's be clear. That's the end of the quote from the editorial. Let's be clear. I don't think any discussion of impediments to effective information sharing can be complete without discussing the need to reorganize the executive branch. This committee has held several hearings on the need to reauthorize executive reorganization authority, which expired in 1984. The authority existed off and on for a period of 50 years, giving presidents the ability to submit executive branch reorganization proposals to the Congress for a guaranteed up or down vote without amendment. In doing so, executive branch reorganizations could come before Congress without getting buried in congressional committee jurisdictional turf battles that have spelled the demise of many governmental reorganization proposals in recent history. I may take some heat for saying this, but we need to look no further than the deliberations that led to the creation of Homeland Security Department for evidence that Congress is not terribly well equipped to tackle organizational challenges. Too much turf, too many egos, far too much time. The recommendations made by the 9/11 Commission make reauthorization of this authority all the more urgent. The obsolete, redundant, and duplicative nature of the federal bureaucracy is the single greatest impediment to improving information sharing. As hearings held by this committee over the past 2 years have shown, the same problem of poor organizations exists in federal food safety oversight, federal child welfare functions, and multiple homeland security functions. In our battle to move forward to better protect ourselves, there are no Republicans or Democrats, only Americans. Talking to my kids and countless others in Northern Virginia, one thing is clear: a whole generation of Americans will grow up with 9/11 as its most formative experience. This younger generation is no longer cynical about the idea of we the people. They realize that these attacks were not just on the people who were killed and injured, but also on the very things that define us as a society: religious freedom, equality, economic opportunity, political choice. And this generation will know that the ruthless will not inherit the earth. Without further ado, I welcome all the witnesses to today's hearing. I look forward to their testimony, and I now recognize our distinguished ranking member, Mr. Waxman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Is this mic on? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This does feel awfully good to sit here in the. Well, I want to thank you for holding this hearing. This is a timely and important hearing. Understanding and acting on the recommendations of the 9/11 Commission should be an urgent national priority. Let me begin by welcoming the family members of the 9/11 victims. those testifying today, and the thousands of family members you represent. Without your resolve, the 9/11 Commission would not have been established, and we would never have learned as much as we now know about the truth of what happened. And without your commitment, we would not be considering the Commission's recommendations or even holding this hearing. Because of you, our nation will be safer, and we thank you. I also want to thank John Layman and Bob Carey, who served on the 9/11 Commission and who will be testifying today. The 9/11 Commission produced an extraordinarily important report with dozens of concrete recommendations for fighting terrorism and making our nation safer. And the Commission did so unanimously, achieving a rare bipartisan consensus. We owe Secretary Layman and Senator Kerry a debt of gratitude, and we ignore their recommendations at our peril. The recommendations of the 9/11 Commission are getting attention right now. In fact, the House has over a dozen hearings scheduled this month alone. But I've been around long enough to know what is likely to happen next. Without sustained public pressure, Congress will vacillate and the administration will temporize, and we will end up with a pale shadow of the bold action recommended by the 9/11 Commission. Indeed, this may already have started to happen. The 9/11 Commission recommended major reforms in our intelligence agencies. The Commission recommended the creation of a National Intelligence Director who would be in charge of a new National Counterterrorism Center. The Commission proposed giving the National Intelligence Director the authority to wield real power. The director would control the budgets of the intelligence agencies and would have direct management authority over the head of the CIA and other intelligence agencies. But this doesn't appear to be what President Bush had in mind. The President yesterday spoke about giving the National Intelligence Director the authority to coordinate and monitor the actions of the intelligence agencies. But he made no mention of giving the intelligence director the authority to control the intelligence budgets. And he specifically said that the new intelligence director will not be in, quote, the chain of command. In this city, if you have a fancy title, but you're not in the chain of command and you don't control the budget, you're a figurehead. And another figurehead is not what the 9/11 Commission recommended and what our nation needs. The 9/11 Commission made over 40 concrete recommendations. Its recommendations cover a wide range of crucial subjects: how to protect our borders, how to safeguard our transportation systems, how to support our first responders, how to conduct an assessment of risks and vulnerabilities. All of these recommendations are essential. We will be doing the nation a grave disservice if we ignore any of them. Let me give you an example of why I'm so concerned about the fate of the recommendations. The 9/11 Commission warned about the dangers of weapons of mass destruction getting into the hands of Al-Qaeda. Here's a quote from the report. Our report shows that Al-Qaeda has tried to acquire or make weapons of mass destruction for at least 10 years. There is no doubt the United States will be a prime target. Preventing the proliferation of these weapons warrant a maximum effort by strengthening counterproliferation, end quote. Here's what the Bush administration did last week. It killed international efforts to strengthen nuclear weapons inspections. This is a quote from a front page article in the Washington Post on Saturday. Quote, in a significant shift of U.S. policy, the Bush administration announced this week that it will oppose provisions for inspections and verification as part of an international treaty that would ban production of nuclear weapons materials. Arms control specialists said the change in U.S. position will dramatically weaken any treaty and make it harder to prevent nuclear materials from falling into the hands of terrorists, end quote. Well, the cynicism is breathtaking. a week after the 9/11 Commission recommends greater non-proliferation efforts, the administration undermines an international non-proliferation treaty. And then it says it is doing everything possible to fight terrorism and implement the recommendations of the 9/11 Commission. Despite their merit, many of the ideas in the report from the 9/11 Commission have encountered resistance. Nearly 3 years ago, a bipartisan group of members from this committee urged the administration to develop a coherent strategy based on a comprehensive threat and risk assessment. Over 2 years ago, Representative David Obey, the ranking member of the House Appropriations Committee, and I wrote the Bush administration to recommend the creation of a White House office that could unify the collection and dissemination of intelligence. Over 1 year ago, Representative Jane Harman, the ranking member of the House Intelligence Committee, introduced legislation to establish a National Director of Intelligence. And over the past year, Representative Jim Turner, the ranking member of Homeland Security Committee, has repeatedly proposed initiatives that closely parallel recommendations of the 9/11 Commission. But all of these suggestions have fallen on deaf ears. Secretary Ridge never even bothered to respond to the letter that Mr. Obey and I sent over 2 years ago, in fact, recommending what we now have before us. It could have been done 3 years ago. It could have been put into effect 2 years ago. It could have been effective 1 year ago. We rushed into creating a Homeland Security Agency, and we ignored the problems of coordinating the intelligence, which we all knew from September 11th was the biggest problem we had. With so much at stake, we can't let that happen again. The 9/11 Commission has spoken. Now it is Congress's turn and this administration to work with us in order to act to make those recommendations become the law of this country. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Wasn't sure I was going to get the chair back that easy, but thank you very much. I understand our first witnesses are not here yet. So what I'm going to do is, when we get our commission members here, we'll go immediately. But until that time, with Mr. Waxman, with your concurrence, we'll alternate with opening statements. And I'll go with Mr. Shays, whose subcommittee has led the way on so many of these issues.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a good day, and it can't be a partisan day. As the third anniversary of the September 11th attacks approaches, we finally have a credible, comprehensive picture of what went so horribly wrong and what needs to be done to prevent further tragedy. The recommendations of the 9/11 Commission rise from the ashes of Ground Zero, the rubble at the Pentagon, and the wreckage in Pennsylvania, demanding action by the living in the cause of those who died. The task of implementing the major reforms outlined by a unanimous bipartisan commission will not be easy. As the commission's vice chair observed, the status quo always has an entrenched army of defenders. But the September 11th families will hear from today have no patience with apologists for a system which failed them so totally and so personally, nor should they. Their status quo changed forever that September morning. They ask now only that we act quickly to change the dated structures and flawed practices that contributed to their profound grief. Many of the recommendations strike familiar chords. In the course of 20 hearings on terrorism issues before September 11th, the National Security Subcommittee, which I chaired, discussed the need for unified threat assessment, sharper strategic focus on the real enemy, and the need to restructure government to meet the threat. Three national commissions, Bremer, Gilmore, Hart-Rudman, presaged the commission's call for structural and operational reforms within and between levels of government. Many of these recommendations went unheeded until it was too late. It took unimaginable tragedy to bring us to this moment. Only courage, foresight, and imagination will propel our actions in time to prevent the next calamity. These recommendations should be a unifying force, a mandate to put past divisions and biases behind us and heed the lessons so sadly learned. In closing, I can congratulate the 9/11 Commission for a job extraordinarily well done. And I thank the families for their courage and determination and love for this country and their efforts to make sure that life will be different for the next generation.
Thank you, Mr. Chase. We'll have one more opening statement, and then we'll go right to our panelists. Thank you all for being with us. Mr. Kendrowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Waxman. I appreciate the opportunity to offer my views at the first hearing in the House on the final report of the National Commission on Terrorist Attacks upon the United States. Late last month, the 9/11 Commission released its much-anticipated final report, which examines the circumstances surrounding the September 11th attacks and provides recommendations for preventing future terrorist strikes. This report is the culmination of 19 days of public hearings, a review of 2.5 million pages of documents, interviews of 1,200 individuals in 10 countries, and public testimony of 160 witnesses. As we begin our review of the 9/11 report, I would urge my colleagues to consider the recommendations of the Commission as a whole rather than identifying a single proposed reform for review or examining these matters on a piecemeal basis. By focusing only on certain aspects of the report, we risk losing the overall intent of the Commission's recommendations. We need to see the forest and the trees, not either the forest or the trees. Nevertheless, today's hearing is intended to consider recommendations of the Commission regarding the creation of a National Intelligence Director and the formation of the National Counterterrorist Center within the Executive Office of the President. These recommendations have already sparked considerable public debate. On the one hand, the National Intelligence Director and the National Counterterrorism Center must have independent budgetary authority and the ability to make personnel changes as necessary. In addition, the director must have the ability to do so without pressure from the intelligence agencies under its jurisdiction. On the one hand, placing the center and the director within the executive office of the president may shift the intelligence operations closer to the politics within the White House and may influence the intelligence gathering system. Such a result could cause considerable concern for me. Moreover, I'm very troubled by recent press reports that indicate that the president may unilaterally issue an executive order to create the position of National Intelligence Director. In doing so, no congressional confirmations would be held to ensure the director is properly vetted. In implementing the recommendations of the Commission, we must provide the appropriate checks and balances. As we begin our review of the recommendations included in the 9/11 report, we also need to ensure that Congress adequately addresses these matters in the long term. I have therefore joined with many of my colleagues in supporting legislation to extend the 9/11 Commission for 18 months in order to oversee the implementation of its recommendations. I would urge the other members of our panel to also support this bipartisan bill.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kendrowski. We have our panelists with us today, and let me just thank you on behalf of Mr. Wax and myself for your work on this commission. It's a very important report. Both of you had long, distinguished careers in public service before you came to this commission, which I won't outline now, but we're very pleased to have you with us today. It's our policy we swear in members before you testify, so if you rise with me, raise your right hand. Solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give to be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Thank you very much. So, Senator Kerry, I think we'll start with you and then go to Secretary Lehman. And thank you both for being with us. We have a button you got to push here. You turn it on.
In the mic itself.
Oh, there it is. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Right off the bat, I'm going to disobey you and have Secretary Lehman lead off, if you don't mind.
That's fine.
Came off vacation. Asked for your request, and he's much better prepared than I am.
All right.
Well,
and you don't need to take your full time. So if you just want to be here for questions, that's fine as well. But your report
speaks for itself. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have together submitted a statement for the record. I won't belabor you with that and reread it to you, but I'd like to start by thanking all of you for the support that you have given us, both in bringing us into existence and then helping us to carry forward our responsibilities. This has been a remarkable experience for all of us. We are five Democrats and five Republicans. None of us have been particularly known as being pussycats in the past, and we had our strong views and positions. And through the process of deep study of these issues and the facts of the investigation, we have ended up entirely unanimous, not a single dissent, not a single additional view, and with total unity of purpose. And I'm very pleased to see that this committee is approaching the issues, our findings and our recommendations in exactly the same nonpartisan spirit with a unified purpose to get these changes done to make this country safer. We are very pleased, all of us, with the reaction of the leaders of Congress, the reaction of Senator Kerry and his campaign, and the reaction and action of the President in moving out very smartly to analyze and implement these recommendations. They are very important, and while the organizational recommendations are the ones that naturally attract the most attention, they are not the most important. The most important are the recommendations that we lead with: what to do, the strategy, the objectives and priorities that are needed to win this war against Islamist terrorism. You will never ensure security by moving around organization charts. You will never determine human behavior by trying to design a better organization chart. But it's unacceptable to have institutions that have evolved since the Second World War, built over time to deal with the Cold War and its threats, hemmed in with a variety of restrictions and regulation over time that were appropriate when put in but are no longer appropriate. It's time for an entirely new system of providing our nation's leaders and the congressional leaders with the intelligence they need to make wise policy and decisions. Our recommendations are not a Chinese menu. They are a whole system. If all of the important elements are not adopted, it makes it very difficult for the others to succeed. And one last comment before going to your questions and after hearing Senator Kerry's comment, I would strongly recommend that these be viewed as a whole, and that the powers needed to carry out these recommendations be enacted as a whole package. And I'm sure that this will result in a far more effective means of providing intelligence to this nation going forward, if they are implemented. Senator Kerry.
Thank you very much. Senator Kerry.
Well, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, let me first of all say what Secretary Lehman just said, which was a remarkable thing happened to this commission. There were 10 of us selected by, as you know, elected officials in the city of Washington, D.C., where there's a considerable amount of partisan strife, and we reached a unanimous conclusion in spite of that. And I would say, from as I scratch my head and try to figure out why, it is no small measure due to the insistence of the families who are responsible for this legislation, but were present at every single one of our hearings and present with us in spirit at all of our deliberations, as well as a careful reading of the narrative. If you read the narrative, and I know that it is a long narrative, including the footnotes, but if you read the narrative, I believe it'll put you in the right mood, and I think that's what happened to us. We got back in the mood of that terrible day, and the mood that happened for 60, 90, whatever it was afterwards, days afterwards. I mean, the nation and the world truly were united. I mean, I live in New York City today, and it was remarkable for me to see the Yankees get cheered at Comiskey and get cheered at Fenway, because not because people love the Yankees, but because people felt a unity with New York that was truly moving. And I think the narrative puts you in that spirit. The narrative allows you to go back to that terrible but also wonderful moment when the nation rallied together. The things that I've noticed in the news that have been covered, there are several that have not been covered. I presume that you have a lot of questions on the structure of the government, and a lot of that is dealt with in our opening statement. The foundation for what we're talking about, however, is a belief that this is not a war on terrorism. It really is a war on, in this case, a narrow and small group of radical jihadists who believe that killing infidels is something that's a good thing to do, and believe that the United States of America is, to use Osama bin Laden's words, the head of the snake. And we unanimously conclude that vigorous and relentless military and law enforcement effort are going to be necessary. We unanimously concluded that we're going to have to engage in the ideas that we've for too long left in the shadows. We unanimously concluded that we needed to also develop an agenda of hope that the United States of America leads to try to implement in the world. Of the five areas of action, I know that the restructuring of the government is the dominant one, but I call to your attention, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, that there are a number of areas where funding is the problem, especially in border security, especially having to do with these paper documents that we all carry around called passports. There are significant vulnerabilities that still remain simply because the timeline for the implementation of U.S. visit program extends all the way out to 2010. There are management issues that have to be addressed. That's a constant problem that you, Mr. Chairman, this committee is constantly dealing with the executive branch. Thirdly, there is the issue of secrecy. In my strongly held opinion, secrecy is an enormously difficult problem for us. I think we overclassify to a fault, but more importantly for the Congress, as a consequence of there being secrecy, there, you do not have investigative journalists doing the kind of oversight that you have in every other walk of life when it comes to the federal government. There's simply, you don't wake up in the morning and read the Washington Times or Washington Post and see some investigative story that's out there that provokes you to do oversight. It's not there with our intelligence agencies. And you need to recognize, I think, the limitations that imposes upon Congress. Fourthly, there's a number of areas where further investigation is necessary. Time merely ran out on us. I love John Kerry. I intend to vote for him. I was my confidence in him was shaken when he said that we ought to work for 18 more months. One of the reasons that I think that came about is that we were actually, because we had subpoena powers in this unique position, we were doing congressional oversight. And I would urge you to think about that and try to come up with an alternative way to do that on a permanent basis. I know that Congressman Shays was frustrated in trying to exert oversight over the intelligence agencies. There's a rightful place for Congress here, which brings me to my fifth point, those things where law, changes in the law are going to be necessary. I'm strongly of the view that what Congress needs to do is to see this as a moment when you've got to push back on the executive branch. You need more power and authority. My first preference is a joint intelligence committee that is created in law, not by congressional resolution. These intelligence agencies respect the law, much less respectful of congressional resolutions. Secondly, that law should say that Congress has to be kept fully and completely informed, not informed in their intelligence failures, but fully and completely informed. In my view, again, because of secrecy, that this committee should be required to report on an annual basis the status of our intelligence agencies. There's no such thing as an operational readiness inspection as there is with our military. There needs to be some public declaration of where we are. I believe a joint committee would be the preferable way for Congress to push back. It is a much stronger position, Congress versus the executive branch, than perhaps the executive branch would want. But from my evaluation, the stronger the better, the more likely it is that Congress is going to get the kind of oversight necessary to make certain that we sustain this effort to strengthen our intelligence capabilities over the long term. Mr. Chairman, I think I don't know if I went 5 minutes.
No, that's fine. Thank you very much. Well, let me start the question and let me put my 5 minutes up. Let me ask you both what your views are on the President's announcement yesterday. The Commission proposed establishing a Senate-confirmed intelligence director in the White House. The White House proposed establishing such a position outside the White House. that we get into the line of, you know, budget control and the like. Do either of you have a reaction to that?
Well, I think it's a very good start, a good opening bid. It it is a responsible first step to start the process, which most importantly, I think in working out the details, will go on up here in Congress, in your committee, and in your Senate counterpart. The rationale for creating a National Intelligence Director is not based on creating a new layer of bureaucracy, far from it. It makes no sense at all unless it has the power to break up bureaucratic layers, to remove bureaucratic layers, to dismantle the vertical stovepipes that make it impossible in many cases for the real sharing of intelligence between agencies. That's the purpose. So to carry it out, this National Intelligence Director has to have hiring and firing power. He has to have not just budget coordination power, but budget and appropriations and reprogramming power. Must have power over the IT protocols that now provide enormous technological barriers between our intelligence agencies and the sharing of data. And has the power to bring rationality to the security system of classification, compartmentalization, declassification, security clearance granting, and background investigations. Those four powers are essential. Without them, it will become just another layer.
Yeah, I think it's a very good start. I'm pleased to see it begin. I do think that unless and under law, my mic's not on.
Right. Yeah, I think we got
Can
it.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
I think it's a very good beginning. The President deserves credit for coming out of the box with endorsement of the NID and the NCTC. This is not a new argument, especially the NID. We all that were here during the 90s remember when the Alder James spy case broke and suddenly we had a commission to investigate what went wrong. Les Aspin first and then Harold Brown chaired that. They came out with a set of recommendations. And indeed, Brent Scowcroft at the start of the second Bush administration did the same thing, evaluated what needed to be done. And everybody that looks at it comes to the same conclusion. The person that has the responsibility needs the authority. And absent that, they're not going to be able to get the job done. I mean, it's a fairly simple rule in life, and it's especially important in government. And right now, the person that has the responsibility, the person that gets called up to the Hill, the person that gets the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence do evaluation and kick the bejesus out of him, and the House as well, is the Director of Central Intelligence. But he doesn't have budget authority, doesn't have hiring authority. And after Aspin Brown, we tried to get some of it done. And what happened was the Department of Defense and the Armed Services Committee killed us. That's what happened. We had to take the Armed Services Defense Authorization Bill, the Senate Select Committee did, on sequential referral in order just to get concurrent review. That's what happened. And for the rest of my time in the Senate, I didn't get a damn thing out of the Armed Services Committee because it made them mad. Especially the staffers were quite upset with us for taking that bill on sequential referral. And that's the fault line. I know that Secretary Rumsfeld is going to oppose this, and I just, if they win one more time, if DOD wins one more time, the next time there's a dust-up and there's a failure, don't call the Director of Central Intelligence up here. Kick the crap out of DOD, because they're the one with the statutory authority over budget. Appropriations goes to DOD for national foreign intelligence. Please don't tell me it's going to deteriorate our capacity to support the war fighters. We don't touch tactical intelligence in this recommendation. So if it's not done, if DOD and the Armed Services Committee win one more time, then the next time you have a problem, don't call the Director of Central Intelligence up and blame them. Because they have responsibility, but they don't have either budgetary or personnel authority to be able to get the job done.
Thank you. The recommendations for reorganization in the report focus largely on the intelligence-related functions. But Senator Kerry, let me ask you, wouldn't you agree that we don't necessarily have to stop there, that the problem goes deeper than just the intelligence community? A number of federal functions out there that are organized just as haphazardly as intelligence functions that could impact Homeland Security?
Yeah. I mean, I would say it's, you know, sort of the preamble to the Constitution. We're always trying to be a more perfect union, not a perfect one. So yeah. Somebody tells me the government screwed up, I says, yeah, okay, it's screwed up. It's a constant process of trying to make it better. And it's never a process where you expect that it's going to be perfect. And by the way, Mr. Chairman, I have no reason to blow smoke at you guys and gals here, but this committee can perform a very important function in providing oversight. I'm going to underscore, I believe, one of the reasons that there's consideration being given to extending the 9/11 commission is we really were doing oversight. People were nervous when we were showing up.
Yeah.
They were afraid that, oh, my God, what are they going to say about us? Well, they ought to have the same sort of respect and fear at times when you all show up with your subpoena powers. And it seems to me that tucked in there is a very important point. I was on the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence for 8 years. I was vice chairman under Senator Shelby and under Senator Specter. I think the committee did good oversight up to where it could. But it's not created under law. It doesn't have the kind of authority that it needs to have. It can't demand full and complete accounting. And there's no investigative journalism out there digging up stuff that we're missing. So it seems to me in this area, there's a real need for Congress to say, we've got to create stronger capability on our part in order to be able, in this particular area where you don't have the kind of investigative journalistic oversight, where you can influence what the executive branch is doing, regardless of who is president, more than you currently can.
Thank you very much. Mr. Waxman.
Well, I appreciate the work the two of you and your fellow members of the commission have done, and your presentation here today. You both seem pretty passionate that we need somebody in charge of intelligence. And then you both said you thought the president's proposal was a good start. Don't you think we need to get on to doing what we need to do fast? Because we're going to only be here another month or two or three, and if we're going to pass a bill, we ought to pass a really good bill. Would either of you be satisfied if we passed a bill like the one the president suggested yesterday? Because he suggested what we need is to have a director who could coordinate the budgets, not control them. Let's start with that one. Do you think that's a good enough?
Well, the devil isn't.
I don't think your mic is on.
The devil is in the details. I think that the fact that here we are a day after the president proposed this, and you are hard at work preparing to begin to do this legislation, is very encouraging. It is not enough to coordinate, and I don't think the president really was drawing the line there at all. I think that in order for him to have all hands on deck there supporting these initiatives, that he didn't have to jawbone every one of them into every last detail of our recommendations. There's time to bring them along, and you're going to play an essential role in bringing them along. So I don't see anything that is contradictory. I think by the end of the process, I'm confident that the word coordinate, while it might still be there, will be subservient to direct in the executive sense, because those powers must be given, and I don't believe the president will oppose them. I think unlike the rest of us, he has a whole administration that he's got to kind of herd along and keep consensus in. So I think.
I appreciate your optimism about it, but Senator Kerry, what are your views? It seems to me that unless the commission demands that we act to keep intact their proposal and not have it watered down and made ineffective, unless the families of the 9/11 victims continue to press in the next several months, isn't it more likely than not, from your experience as a senator, that this is all going to get watered down into coordinate and the lowest common denominator to satisfy the bureaucracy that don't want change?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that was a forthright answer, and I appreciate it. But that seems to me.
You gave me the opportunity to go yes or no, Congressman.
Well, what about the management authority of this National Intelligence Director? The President suggested that there'd be no operational responsibilities with this new counterterrorism center, and they wouldn't have control over State Department, CIA, FBI, Defense, Homeland Security, and other agencies. Do you feel that there has to be more than just control over the budgets, but management control over these other agencies? Senator Kerry, why don't we start with you this time?
Well, yes, I do. I mean, in this case, I'll align myself with the executive director of the 9/11 Commission, who said in some instances, and this would be one, it would be better to do nothing. The NCTC is in response to the observation the National Security Council's budget has gotten 50% bigger since 9/11, but they're now down in the weeds doing operational things. They're doing planning. They're doing J3 work, to use a DOD phrase. And what we envision is to create the NCTC, not to make it a larger bureaucracy, but to enable the National Security Council to get back to what it's supposed to be doing, which is the larger policy disputes and the larger policy debates that are always going to break out between DOD and Secretary of State and others in the national security structure. So I think, in my view, by the way, on the NID, this has been studied and studied and studied. So the fault line will always be between the Department of Defense and the National Foreign Intelligence. And the question will be whether or not, in this particular instance, we can rise to it. And I think you'll see, not just John and I think you'll see the 9/11 Commission stay very much unified, respectful. Congressman, I mean, we have to be respectful of the President. It is an initiative that he has taken. We have to be respectful of that initiative, but in that moment of being respectful, point out that if all it is consultative, if all it is advisory, then you're better off not doing it. Taking action if the action produces another agency that doesn't have real statutory authority.
I share your concern. If you look at the failures in our intelligence, they're really quite breathtaking. Not only 9/11, where we had some clues, but we forgot to, or were unable to connect the dots, but you look at what happened in Iraq, where they were desperately trying to find evidence, not ignoring evidence, but trying to find evidence to fit into a preconceived political notion. And in the late 1990s, we had the FBI looking for a plot by the Chinese to interfere with our elections and our political process, at the same time that Robert Hansen was selling information to the Russians and endangering our national security. And the intelligence agencies didn't know about the underground tests if I can just complete my thought, Mr. Chairman, in India and the Chalabi debacle, all these things, it seems to me, cry out for us to enact the kind of recommendations you've given us so we could put this intelligence system back into some coherent place. I urge you all to continue pressing the Congress and the President to get these reforms enacted.
Thank you. Mr. Shays.
Thank you. In spite of some of the partisan rhetoric that I know we're going to be hearing in the weeks and months to come, I think we're going to get the job done, and I think we are, just by the tone that both of you are setting today. You're not getting tempted to take political shots at either side. And your report doesn't either. And it's almost sacred to me what you guys have done, and ladies. I mean, it is almost sacred. And I believe it's going to lead to some great things. When I look at your recommendations, I wonder what can be done administratively, what can be done through executive order, what can be done through regulation, what can be done through law, statute, and what can be done or has to be done through House and Senate rules. And I just want to parenthetically say, I will not vote for any rule of the House that doesn't have these reforms next year. For instance, if we don't create a committee that oversees the Department of Homeland Security that has total oversight, I'm not voting for a rule. And I'm not going to, because I think if I did, I would be putting my country in danger. That's basically my mindset. Tell me, what are the things, I realize this is a package, but what are the things you want us to do first? Because I don't think it's all going to come out in one bill. What would you want to see us do first before anything else?
Well, I would say that, ironically, the most important thing to do is to fix the congressional issues. As you say, the Homeland Security, we strongly endorse a joint committee on intelligence with appropriating powers. Fix that first if there has to be a priority, because the rest of the system that we're recommending will not function properly without Congress fixing its own committee structure and jurisdiction. Next, I would say, enact the the National Counterterrorism Center and the National Intelligence Director with the powers that we recommend. Again, our model here is not a super consolidated, making one big agency or a new bureaucracy. The model is the kind of General Electric and other large successful corporate model where you have a very small, powerful CEO and headquarters staff, where you don't try to micromanage the refrigerator division and the jet engine division. You give them objectives, you provide them the tools. If they don't produce or they don't pursue the corporate policy, you remove the people who are obstructive and replace them with people that do it. You don't try to run the operations themselves. That's the model that we are recommending here, and it's of a piece. It all goes together. The National Counterterrorism Center and the other national centers, for instance, for proliferation that we're recommending, all are enabled by a powerful national intelligence director. So it is of one piece, and those two, if you want symbols, are the most important.
Well, I don't know, Congressman. I mean, I agree with John. I do think if you can get the congressional oversight piece done and create a much stronger committee under law with much greater enforceable requirements that we currently have, I think a lot of it's going to take care of itself. Especially since I strongly believe one of the things that's really difficult in democracy is that it's oftentimes the little things that are most important. So it may not be big enough deal for the Times or the Post or somebody to cover it, and because it passes unanimously, nobody's going to pay attention to it. But those little changes in the government operations oftentimes determine the difference between success and failure. That the only thing when it comes to doing first that I would recommend, among the things that I found to be most helpful in getting in the right mood to agree with John, which you got to be in the right mood to agree with John, and he's got to be even in better mood to agree with me, is to read the sentencing statements of the 1997 trial of Ramzi Youssef, the mastermind of the World Trade Center bombing, and to read the sentencing statement of Judge Duffy in that trial. There is an ideological fault line here, and you got to come to terms with it. And if you don't come to terms with it, you get it wrong. It's not about a mechanical response to a mechanical problem. There are ideas that are being argued on the planet today, and those ideas are gaining currency and gaining ground in areas that we think that they shouldn't be gaining currency and gaining ground. I mean, I would urge you. The report itself is too darn long to process in a short period of time. But ask your staff to get the 97 sentencing statement of Ramzi Youssef and the sentencing statement of Judge Duffy, because it describes the fault line and describes where these arguments are. I've heard people say, well, these guys are all evildoers and they're all cowards. Now, read this statement, and what you'll see is a political argument, distorted and messed up and dangerous, but you'll hear a political argument. They're confronted, I think, in the absolute correct way by Judge Duffy, but you hear it in a way that I think will enable you to sustain the motivation that you're going to need through all the difficulty of trying to change these laws.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Kanjorski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If I could just ask a few questions in terms of how do you envision the national director? Is he going to be of cabinet status? Or is he replaceable and fireable by the president, or does he have a term of years? How do we make sure that he isn't just a tool, as perhaps some people have suggested Mr. Tenet became in the last several years, of responding to the needs of the White House rather than having an independent mind?
Well, we are silent in our recommendations as to cabinet membership. I think most of us think that cabinet membership is not a particularly good idea, but cabinet level, that is executive level one, is essential.
But would he have a term that was independent of?
No, we have not recommended that he or she have a specific term, because he will have such power that he needs to serve at the pleasure of the president. He must be confirmed by the Senate. Must be responsive to the Congress. But
we'd be retreating from the director of the FBI and the present CIA director. They have a term of years.
Well, the CIA director, I don't believe, has a term of years. The FBI does, and I'm not so sure that that's a successful model to pursue myself. But we did not address that. We are silent on the issue of term. But I would like to follow up what underlies your question. It's essential to keep policy and intelligence separate. And in the structure that we're recommending, that is maintained in the all-source National Counterintelligence Center and the other centers for fusing intelligence by professional analysts providing the purely objective, as much as humanly impossible, product. And if you will, the National Intelligence Director is the person the President holds responsible for the integrity of this process to bring forward to the National Security Council. And I personally think the practice that has grown up in the past few years of the President requiring that professionals be brought along for the daily briefing, that he gets to see and hear the professional analysts who are most expert in the particular area or subject matter. This provides an ideal setup for that, where the President will have visibility. The National Counterterrorist Center Director will be confirmed by the Senate. He will be known to the President. So you won't have the danger of a National Intelligence Director becoming the monopoly source of information to the President.
Mr. Secretary, I'm sort of worried. As I gather, the conclusion of the Commission is that this is a threat above and beyond what we've imagined it to be, this fundamental Islamic movement worldwide. And I don't have enough information to make the judgment myself. But we have to balance that with the Constitution and the preservation of the Constitution. The one thing that worried me is I was thinking of the old NKVD leader in the Soviet Union, Barak, who succeeded to become prime minister by virtue of the fact that he ran the secret police. If we centralize that authority and give them a $40 billion-plus budget to control at will, doesn't this askew the authority that it may become uncontrollable? And the protection that we're doing all this for to save the Constitution may be dissipated.
It's a very legitimate question to raise and to address, and I think the answer to it is the control must be exercised by the Congress. That's why we insist that he or she be confirmed and accountable to and at the beck and call of the committees of Congress. But it's no different. In fact, if you compare the powers, the inherent powers of the Secretary of Defense compared to this intelligence director, the intelligence directors pale in comparison to what we've put into the centralized Secretary of Defense. So we believe it is manageable. We're recommending other protections of civil liberties and oversight board and justice and so forth, because these are real legitimate issues that have to be kept constant. We can't let the pendulum swing totally over to security at the expense of civil liberties.
Some people suggest there may be a political ideas in Congress, and I just wanted, if I may extend this, and for 6 years of the last administration, all I did was sit on committees and hearings and oversight, but I can't remember anything the last 3 years of oversight. We can't even get subpoenas for the Defense Department.
Thank you. Mr. Schrock.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Commissioners, thank you both for being here. Thanks for taking the politics out of it. Thanks for being brutally frank. It's most welcome and very refreshing, I can assure you. Throughout your report, comparisons are made between the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the new structure that you advocate for the NID. The Joint Chiefs are used as an example of a successful Joint Operations Planning Agency that is the type of capability that we hope to instill in our intelligence community. I don't have the exact numbers, but I know the Joint Chiefs is very large, numbering in the thousands, and exists as a separate, robust agency that draws on the finest officers from the various military services. If this type of capability is desirable, why did the Commission recommend that a modest NID directorate with a relatively small staff is just another presidential advisor? Why not advocate a more robust capability that can truly steer the multiple intelligence agencies and make meaningful demands of their resources and budgets? You know, joint duty is is currently sought after, a prestigious assignment for many military officers and a requirement for promotion to a general rank or admiral rank. Should similar joint intelligence analysis and operation planning experience be required for promotion above a certain level in the intelligence community?
Well, Congressman, I appreciate the question. I think the recommendations that we're making for the NID is, even though we do envision it being a relatively small agency, has substantially enhanced powers. We do cross the line and say that we think that DIA, that NRO, that NGA, that NSA, that these agencies, the directors, should be recommended by the NID director. Or the NID secretary, whatever you end up with, that they should have the power to make the recommendation. Under current law, they have consultative authority, and that's all. Under current law, the appropriations goes to the Department of Defense, and we're recommending the appropriations go to this new director or secretary. And as, it doesn't take a lot of intelligence to figure this out, but that will give this director and this individual a substantial amount of power and authority. But I also want to use this as an opportunity to point out, although I don't want to be filibustering you with my answer.
Please.
I did want to point out that in my case, my vision for this is not so much that we're creating new structures or a czar or super agencies, but that we really need to be building the network that allows the person with the question to get in contact with the person that's got the answer. I'd urge you again to read, there's a memorandum for the record produced by Major General Russell, I think his name's pronounced Honore. He was, I think, SYNC of NORTHCOM in 2003 when we did our memorandum for the record. And basically what he's saying is we're heading towards a train wreck of computer interoperability, where the first responders won't be able to make contact with the person at the top. And nothing in this whole thing was more painful than listening to Mohammed Atta say, we have planes, American Airlines knew it, and the Department of Defense didn't. Yeah. All the way through that day, you see this interoperability problem. So some of this is not so much giving somebody the authority, but having a vision for a management network that enables that person that's got the question out there, wherever they are, to get in contact with the person that's got the answer, especially a person that's got the answer with the capability of deploying resources to help that individual solve their problem.
By the way, your idea of joint tours that works so well now after Goldwater Nichols is a very good one, and it is. I hope we'll see some language to that effect in the legislation, which is why we recommend and believe firmly that the National Intelligence Director has to have personnel authorities to ensure that that kind of thing happens.
Well, the point that John actually made right after we did our interview with former President Clinton, that one of the problems, however, with Goldwater Nichols, and I've heard some of the concern about the NID that's sort of on this point, is one of the problems you have with Goldwater Nichols is the president sitting there talking to his Joint Chiefs of Staff and said, what are our options? And you only got one person in the room today. And 20 years ago, you had four people in the room telling you a range of options. And it limits the president's capability. We got down to this, we either have to invade or we have to send in TLAMs. And there was a lot of options in between that were never fully considered. And I think with tragic consequences.
In your minds, is it desirable that the terms of this director overlap different administrations so as to take advantage of institutional knowledge of experience? I've heard a lot of members of the services and the service secretaries, and you were one of those, Mr. Secretary, who said after 4 years you're just learning the job and then you're gone. Should it be an eight-year term? What should it be?
Well, my view is that the professionals, the heads, for instance, of these national centers should have long terms. And not necessarily in statute, but at least an accepted policy that it should be at least a 4, maybe a 6-year term. But I personally do not think, and again, we, the Commission, have taken no position on terms. And it could work with terms, it could work without terms. I personally do not think terms for the most powerful position is a good idea. I think it must serve at the pleasure of the president.
Yeah, I agree with that. And the challenge, of course, is that Warren Buffett has this great line. He says he likes to buy companies that an idiot can run because eventually one will. Well, you got the same problem. You know, you've got to write the law, understanding that every now and then somebody's going to put a real stinker in there to run the darn
thing.
Right. And you got to hope that you know, the body across the way catches enough of it and be able to, you know, exercise some judgment beyond just ideology. So I think that you've got to. I think the NID, if you create an NID with this kind of power, I think you've got to let that individual has to serve at the pleasure of the president. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Ms. Maloney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for calling these hearings so quickly. It's important, and I thank the commission members. I truly do believe that the 9/11 commission is an example of government at its best. We certainly need to act on your recommendations. We don't have time to wait. The terrorists are certainly not going to wait for us to be ready. As one who represents many of the families of 9/11, and some of them are here today to testify, we thank you for your continued determination. They have expressed their desire that all of your recommendations be implemented. And they have stated they will not rest until that happens, and they have even more recommendations. And I look forward to their testimony, and I certainly support their efforts. I would like to turn to one of the areas that, Senator Kerry, you have spoken about many, many times, and that is the high-threat funding formulas. Secretary Ridge testified at your commission hearings in New York City that he believed that our homeland security resources should go, and I quote from him, where the threat exists, end quote. And clearly, that is New York City. We are again in the crosshairs of the Al-Qaeda. But the administration has never offered a plan to Congress for actually fixing the homeland funding formulas to keep them in line with the recommendations of the commission that they be based on threat and risk assessment. And instead, they have continued in an almost discretionary, total way of allocating these funds. Specifically, in the basic homeland grant formula, 60% of it is discretionary in the hands of the administration. And yet they have not allocated that on risk assessment. And I'd like to know whether you believe that should be changed. Secondly, they have ballooned the number of high-threat cities from the original 7 to now over 80, which resulted in aid to New York City, to give one example, and other high-threat cities have the same example. It was cut 69% from $150 million in 2003 to $47 million in 2004. The fire grant resulted in 9 cents going per capita to New York, with over $9 in Montana. And the basic state grant for New York is roughly $5, and Wyoming is over $38. I just last week, the chairman of the House Select Committee was getting ready to introduce a bill that was supposed to provide homeland funding based on risk, but not all of the details are known. It is not even open to the public yet. But we know that it goes away from all high-threat funding and would still guarantee a minimum to each state without the state needing to justify the need for a minimum or even being high-threat. So in your opinion, is that the approach Congress should be adopting? To avoid distributing homeland funds as pork barrel, as you have talked about, and would you elaborate on the work on the committee on high threat formulas and how the funding should be distributed?
Well, Congresswoman, I spent 8 years on the Senate Appropriations Committee, and I'm an advocate of pork. So, I think it's basically 535 people in Congress trying to figure out how the money's going to be spent. I've argued strenuously with those who say, well, we ought to do it all by formula and turn it over to the bureaucrats and let them decide. So my hands aren't clean on this one. I don't think you're going to change that. And I'm not honestly that familiar with the formula itself. And it sounds you know, to go from 8 to 60 cities does sound like one of those mistakes that are so obvious that you probably shouldn't be doing it. But my own view on this is that unless and until you recognize that the likelihood of attacking New York City and Northern Virginia or the nation's capital, Washington, D.C., again, is very great. Unless you sort of come to terms with that, it's going to be very difficult to do the right thing. And in my view, the right thing is to create, if possible, a separate line in DOD and defense appropriations. Because anybody that's involved with fire effort or police effort or OEM effort up in the city of New York is doing the nation's work. New York City's been attacked twice. There's been at least two additional attempts that were intercepted. And if the nation gets attacked again, it's likely that it's going to get New York City is going to be attacked. And I just don't think I don't have much confidence. I'm not wildly enthusiastic about getting into the mess of trying to figure out how to make Congress work better when it comes to doing appropriations. And therefore, the conclusion I reach is that what we should consider is creating a separate line in the DOD authorization so that you recognize right up front that in New York City, it's the front line of our defense efforts against terrorism.
If I could just follow up on that, that's a very good point, because one of the real lacks today is in the connectivity among the firemen, policemen, and the first responders, and between them and as it escalates up through the FEMA, through the National Guard, which are going to be needed to respond in potential attacks in the future, on up until the military. This is something where the Department of Defense has tremendous expertise, has procurement, has technology, has R&D. Fort Monmouth, New Jersey, the head of the Army Signal Corps is just outside of New York. So this is something that should be, I think, a Defense Department responsibility to provide that kind of support to the first responders in the high-target, high-risk cities like New York.
Mr. Chairman, I request permission to place in the record a letter to Congressman Cox urging that the formula be based on assessment of risk and vulnerabilities, and also the statement from this important report, which I hope does not gather dust but is implemented in its entirety, the statement that Homeland Security should be based, the funding formula, strictly on assessment of risk and vulnerabilities. And
thank you. Without
also
objection.
Statements of other areas that are totally within the discretion of the administration now to send additional funding.
Without objection. Mr. McHugh.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you, and to your fellow commissioners for your bipartisan approach to this very, very important issue. Obviously, as a New Yorker and as someone who was in New York City just yesterday, the pain will never go away, nor should it. And as Senator Kerry said in his comments, this entire examination has helped remind us of that desperate day and the emotions we felt. Just for the record, I listened to Senator Kerry's comments about his intention to vote for president. Secretary Lehman, you're under oath. Who will you vote for president?
I am going to vote for President Bush.
Record will note it's a tie. Thank you, gentlemen.
That reflects the national polls, by the way.
Following up, the gentleman from Pennsylvania made some comments about civil liberties concerns that many have expressed. You gentlemen are aware that some of your recommendations, the biometric, national ID card, driver's license, et cetera, has caused some concerns. Next year, major portions of the Patriot Act are set to expire. It's going to be very controversial. I happen to believe that if you had to live under, as a commission, pre-Patriot Act and had to abide by the barriers that existed in intel sharing, you probably couldn't have done your report. From the perspective of the bill and the need to have in a national intelligence director and a counterterrorism center that ability to synthesize, how would you comment as to the efficacy and the need to maintain at least the spirit of the Patriot Act?
Well, Congressman, first of all, I think that I have to declare that anything that has to be called the Patriot Act, I felt like I would have probably voted against it without even reading the darn thing. But having examined it, and I didn't examine it at all until I got on this commission, I think it's really been misdescribed by both, in many cases, extreme supporters and extreme opponents. And what we concluded was that you should just put the burden of proof on the executive branch. Don't get the give the government more investigative powers than are absolutely necessary. Just come if you can get it in that quiet moment where you say, tell me what value added is occurring here. Because if there is value added, no question that we've gotten value added in breaking down the walls and expediting FISA. Although with FISA right now, we get a backlog because we don't have enough people to process the applications. Just like, you know, if you're sitting over there right now working for the National Geospatial Agency with a top secret clearance, the private sector will pay you $20,000 because there's a 15-month backlog on security clearances. So there's a number of areas here. It seems to me that the Patriot Act provokes us to examine beyond just what the law itself does. I mean, I think if it's possible to get to that moment where conservatives are concerned about excessive government power and liberals that are concerned about excessive government power can actually examine the details of the statute, then I think it's you'll extend those things that need to be extended, and you won't extend those things that don't. I'm afraid, based upon my reading of it and my knowledge of it, which is pretty limited, that's the best that I can do.
I appreciate that.
And I would just add that I think overall it has provided a tremendous increase in our security. But in doing that, it has raised the specter that in the future there could be abuses, which is why we have recommended that we set up in the Justice Department a board of oversight specifically to protect privacy and civil liberties and so forth. But its contribution in dismantling the wall and the whole criminal justice mentality of no sharing has been invaluable. So it's important that those essential things be continued and made permanent, and at the same time not losing sight that civil liberties must always be a consideration.
Yeah, but I guess, there will come a day, we may not be able to imagine it today, there'll come a day when the war on terrorism is sort of back to background noise. With 20 years from now, 25, we're always going to have terrorism as a tactic being used by individuals against more powerful people. There's going to come a day when all of a sudden we're going to hear cases where the Patriot Act is sort of used like RICO, not for its intended purposes, but for other purposes. I mean, I know that there's times when conservatives that are concerned about the power of the government and liberals that are concerned about the power of government can come together, and that's what I trust the most when it comes. It's that conversation that I trust the most when it comes to trying to figure out how to get the Patriot Act reauthorized so it can do what John says. It can add value where value is being added. But where it's not necessary, don't extend it. And again, I don't come here with any very specific recommendations. But if it really isn't necessary, I urge you not to extend it.
Well, I thank you both very much. I guess that's the efficacy of sunsetting. And I would just say, Senator, I expect a lot of people both voted for and against it without reading it. So business as usual. Thank you.
Mr. Kucinich.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank both gentlemen for serving on the commission and for each of you in your long, distinguished career in public service, which certainly informed your work on the commission. I want to pick up a little bit from Mr. McCune and the question that he raised. I'm pleased that the 9/11 commission identified civil liberties as an area of major concern. As a matter of fact, page 394 of the report says, while protecting our homeland, Americans should be mindful of threats to vital personal and civil liberties. This balancing is no easy task, but we must constantly strive to keep it right, unquote. And of course, those of us who were involved in the debates over the Patriot Act and have worked to pass amendments to it, were guided by the spirit of Ben Franklin, who said, quote, those who would give up essential liberty to purchase a little temporary safety deserve neither liberty nor safety, unquote. Now, the commission, continuing with its recommendations, on page 395, you know, said that we should, quote, look across the government at the actions we're taking to protect ourselves to ensure that liberty concerns are appropriately considered. And you recommend, as Mr. Lehman has mentioned, at this time of increased and consolidated government authority, there should be a board within the executive branch to oversee adherence to the guidelines we recommend and the commitment the government makes to defend our civil liberties, unquote. Now, members of the committee, I have not yet seen the administration concur with this recommendation. And I would, you know, dare say that, you know, if we are really faced with a challenge here so that we do not permit fear of terrorism to erode our basic liberties and thereby undermine the spirit of America itself. The Commission says, and I quote on page 395, if our liberties are curtailed, we lose the values that we're struggling to defend. Part of what we're dealing with is terrorism. The other part is fear of terrorism. Senator Kerry, you know, you mentioned in your remarks a moment ago about, you know, there's two sides to the question of the Patriot Act. You know, there's, you know, and we have the Patriot Act, which I opposed, these color-coded threat systems. You know, Americans are forever wondering, you know, what does this mean, Code Orange? The CAPS program, total information awareness, discussions about that. You know, there's real concerns about out there around the country about the potential of these structures to curtail our essential liberties, and whether or not these structures open the door to manipulation of information for political purposes. So I think that, you know, aside from the obvious duty that we have as members of Congress taking an oath to defend the Constitution of the United States, this Commission recommendation to create a strong board to oversee the government initiatives and protection of our civil liberties, I think is absolutely critical, and it's something that I believe that we should consider incorporating possibly in the form of an amendment. I would like to ask if either Mr. Kerry or Mr. Lehman would like to elaborate on your vision for a what could be called a federal civil liberties ombudsman, someone to make sure that this quality that we have, that is so essential to who we are as a nation, is not eroded.
Well, the idea, Congressman, came actually from, at least the first time I heard the idea discussed, it came from a discussion of the detainee policy right after 9/11, where we were unable to ascertain any security value added from all those detainee efforts, and felt that there was going to be a need, regardless of what the effort was, to create a force inside the Justice Department that could do this kind of evaluation in an objective fashion. That said, I also have to say that, like, if Ben Franklin were around today, if he'd been on this 9/11 commission and come to terms with Ramzi Youssef and Osama bin Laden and other guys who sit around, talk sort of casually about killing hundreds of thousands of Americans, I do think that he'd say, well, wait a minute, we can't sit around and worry about violating Osama bin Laden and Ramzi Youssef's civil liberties. And remember,
well,
in
Senator, with all due respect,
as you interrupt me. In 98 and 99, we sat around and tried to debate whether or not we're going to pull the trigger to kill Osama bin Laden. We'd had that great debate because we were worried about collateral damage at the moment he was planning to kill 3,000 Americans, trying to acquire nuclear weapons to maybe kill a million. It's right in the report. I mean, you got this stark language of us being concerned. I embrace that concern. I'm glad we lead in those areas. I'm glad we have this concern about civil liberties. It needs to be there. But the enemy has no concerns for civil liberties. The enemy has no concern for the Geneva Convention. And you've got to come with that, and I know you do in this debate, we got to come with that hard-headed attitude, or we're not going to get this thing balanced right. All we're going to do is score a point to an audience that's apt to be sympathetic to our viewpoint.
Mr. Russell, you did not answer my question with respect to the balance.
Well, I answered as best as I can, or as far as I'm going to go today, I guess, Congressman. I mean, where do you find my answer to be inadequate?
How do you protect civil liberties?
I don't think you protect civil liberties absolutely. I don't have an absolute civil liberty to speak freely, to operate freely. I always have to balance what I'm saying against the interests and the rights of another individual. And so if I'm sitting in a mosque somewhere, having a conversation, I think it's a pretty good thing that would happen on 9/11 to kill Americans, and I'd like to perhaps support other people who are doing the same sort of thing. As far as I'm concerned, I just forfeited my right, it seems to me, to not have the government of the United States interfere with either that conversation or my effort to do so. So, I mean, I can't balance it in general, unfortunately. I have to get to the specific thing that we're talking about in order to be able to do that balancing. That's why I say, Congressman, I do think both the mechanism that we're recommending and the general thing I said earlier with the Patriot Act, you got to get to that place where you've got both liberals and conservatives who say we don't want the government to have too much power, because that's, in the end, what you're dealing with. It's not so much civil liberties as it is the power of the government to investigate us without any control over that government, regardless of what it is that you're doing. And I think you need, in our system of government, I think we need real limitations on what the government's able to do with individual citizens. At the same time, we're fighting a war against individuals who don't feel that way.
Ms. Rose Lathan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the gentleman for your service to our country and all the commission members, and for rising above the political rhetoric and the bashing and all of the partisanship that goes on, even as you have heard in this committee. And you've produced a truly bipartisan report that rises above that and that honors the thousands who died on 9/11, honors their grieving family members, and also gives hope to our men and women in uniform throughout the world who are fighting those Islamic extremists who seek our destruction and who've corrupted their religious teachings in such a distorted way that they can state that they're killing for their creator. I wanted to raise two issues that were raised in your report that is currently being debated in our International Relations Committee, and we'll have you appear before us in the coming days. And these legislative proposals that we're putting forth have to do with the information sharing component of your report and the need for executive branch reorganization. I wanted to ask you if you believe that each agency involved in counterterrorism efforts should reorganize their own infrastructure to better integrate and coordinate the intelligence, the policy, the operational components, and should each agency essentially have a single dedicated office or division working exclusively on U.S. counterterrorism policy that will serve as a point of contact to for other U.S. agencies and the soon-to-be-created Terrorism Center. And also another proposal that we're looking at is your observation of the commission that has to do with the need to transform the system of need to know to one of need to share. But there are concerns that increasing the number of individuals with access to intelligence could jeopardize sources and methods, and in turn, that could jeopardize not only our intelligence gathering capabilities, but our operational response as well. And how would you address those concerns and safeguard against these potential problems? Thank you.
I'll start, if I might, answer that. One of the most essential things in reforming our current structure is to rationalize the current security system. as you rightly put it, to change from a need to know to a need to share culture. And that is one more very strong recommendation for a national intelligence director who has that power that cuts across agencies. Today, too many agencies do all their own classifying, do all their own background investigations, do all their own stamping, and when in doubt, stamp at one level higher than it should be. What we are recommending is a cultural change, and that goes to the first part of your question. Should each of the agencies, the 15 agencies, change, reorganize themselves? I believe that what the only reason for making these organizational changes is to bring about a cultural change, to provide an environment in the whole community and in each of the agencies where people can become innovative, can do the right thing, because we have fabulously talented people in each of these agencies that are kind of in shackles because of the bureaucratic process. So if we can change, give the power to somebody at the top to break up these shackles, to remove these obstacles, then each of the agency heads will be able to reorganize their own agencies and bring about a culture of sharing and of putting proper responsibilities where they belong. Specifically in the classification issue, one of the greatest tyrannies in the classification system is what's called originator control. If NSA originates a piece of intelligence, they get to control it, nobody else. If CIA originates a piece, they get to control it. It's called ORCON. That has to be totally changed. We have to have a system where sources and methods are detached as soon as the intelligence is gathered, and then it's fed into the system of sharing free of, so everybody doesn't have to maintain this ORCON compartmentalization throughout. So that is why you're getting an idea why we believe this is a whole. It's not a Chinese menu, these recommendations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Davis.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and the ranking member for convening this hearing. I also want to thank the witnesses for the tremendous work that you've done as part of the commission. And I want to commend the family members for the role that they played in bringing the commission about. On Saturday, the Washington Post ran a front page story that described a significant policy shift by the Bush administration. It announced that it will now oppose inspections and verification as part of an international treaty that would ban the production of nuclear weapons. Senator Kerry, could you give us your views on this? I mean, is the administration going in the right direction, the wrong direction, appropriate direction? What do you think about this?
I wasn't in town Saturday, so I didn't get it. I wasn't in Washington Saturday. I missed that story. So I'm not sure, Congressman, I'm not sure what it is the administration is proposing. I do think that the chem bio nuclear threat is very real, especially nuclear. I think it's almost a question of when, not if, one of these gets used. And at the same time, I must tell you, I think the likelihood of the United States being attacked by terrorists using just straight conventional weapons is a more likely thing. I mean, you all were terrified by a couple of snipers here for a number of months, and that wasn't weapons of mass destruction. So it'd still be pretty easy for me to go out and get a couple hundred pounds of C4 and a time stick and put it someplace where they do a lot of damage. I mean, I just think there are a lot of conventional vulnerabilities. So I don't think that's the question that you asked me, but it's about as far as I can go to answering your question, because I don't know what the administration proposed.
Let me just proceed then. The article went on to say that the administration's position will dramatically weaken any treaty and make it harder to prevent nuclear materials from falling into the hands of terrorists. Mr. Lehman, do you have a view on this?
Well, first of all, I do believe that proliferation efforts have to be redoubled and intensified, that this really is the most serious long-term threat. I agree with Bob that the more immediate is conventional, but the catastrophic is in nuclear. So I am a true believer in nonproliferation, and why we're recommending one of the national centers be a nonproliferation center. However, I also believe in President Reagan's dictum, trust but verify. When you're dealing with nuclear materials, we have found, I mean, I was sent by President Reagan to try to threaten President Zia of Pakistan not to proceed with nuclear weapons. And I sat right across from him at dinner, and he looked me straight in the eye and he said, I give you my word, we are not developing nuclear weapons. And about 2 years later, they had their first test. So I used to be, in one incarnation, the deputy director of the Arms Control Agency. I believe in arms control. I believe in treaties. But they must be verifiable. We cannot take the word. We cannot trust a toothless international organization to verify. We have to have an international organization or national means, such as we developed with the Soviets, that are intrusive but reliable.
Well, let me just ask, because finally the article said that the administration came to its conclusion because such a system would cost too much. The commission report says that preventing proliferation of these weapons warrants maximum effort by strengthening counterproliferation. I assume that the commission felt that the cost would be warranted if we could prevent further proliferation of these weapons. Is that your understanding
the principle, as opposed to its specific, because I don't think any of us on the commission addressed this specific move by the administration, but money spent on reducing proliferation, regardless of the cost, in my judgment, that if it's effective means, is money well spent.
Yeah, I mean, it does look from the article that this weakens verification. I'd want to ask Senator Nunn what he thought of this, or somebody else that's steeped themselves in trying to reduce the threat of nuclear proliferation. And indeed, in our discussions, we pointed to the Nunn-Lugar Act as something that, with the corrections that Congress has made through good oversight, is something that needs additional funding and additional support. So I would seek to deflect your question to somebody that's more knowledgeable than I, because it's oftentimes the case when I see something on the surface, my surface reaction would be, this is going to weaken our capability to stop proliferation. But I would check it with somebody more knowledgeable than I.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it. And let me just say to the panelists here how much we certainly appreciate your dedication to our nation, and you've all had terrific careers, but I think certainly what you've done with the 9/11 Commission will be a marquee of your careers, I think, as well. So I appreciate you coming. I appreciate our chairman calling this hearing, and our leader of our speaker as well. There's a number of different committees we'll be having hearing on this remarkable report that you've brought out, and I think it's very appropriate. I was a little I had some consternation about the Congress going on recess right as you were delivering this remarkable piece of work. And so I think there are a number of things that our committee should be looking at with your recommendations. I'm going to go to something that is so almost ridiculously simple, but so fundamental, and one of your recommendations, and something I have a little bit of expertise in as well. Before I got this job, I was a Michigan Secretary of State, and in that, my principal responsibility was, one of my principal responsibilities was serving as a Chief Motor Vehicle Administrator, issuing driver's licenses, state identification, et cetera. And actually, in your commission's report here on page 390, you've got a recommendation, secure identification should begin in the United States. The federal government should set standards for the issuance of birth certificate sources of identification, such as driver's licenses, et cetera, et cetera. I wonder, during the course of your hearings, as you were taking testimony there, if you found that there was, at least it's been my experience, that there really has not been a federal standard on how we are issuing driver's licenses or state ID cards. This, I think, is the identity. I mean, it's a foundation of your identity. You have a driver's license. That's how you're going to get into a flight school, roll into a flight school, or get on an airplane, or what have you. And yet, all of the various states, there are a number that have very high security, secure driver's licenses, essentially fraudulent free, but there are still a number of states who are issuing driver's licenses, first of all, without requiring any really good essential primary documentation as to the identity of the individual that they are issuing these licenses to. And I think we have a serious problem with that. For instance, with commercial driver's licenses, just reading this latest terrorist threat, we see that there's quite a bit of consternation that much of this terrorist threat could manifest itself in people in trucks, in cars, with bombs. You have, I think, the possibility, certainly, with not having the kind of secure licensing system that we need to have, with people getting commercial driver's licenses, for instance, with hazardous material endorsements. They're literally using our own freedoms against us. And yet the technology does exist out there for us to have not only secure licenses, but biometrics, the retinal scanning, whether or not we would put fingerprints on licenses. I think we all have to be very concerned as we use technology about privacy concerns. At the same time, there certainly is technology there, and it would seem appropriate, and as you make in your recommendations here, that the federal government should be issuing federal standards to the various states. And again, I know we're talking about national security directors, et cetera, but this is such a fundamental thing that every American has and needs to have. And I do think the federal government would have a very appropriate role in this, and I'm just looking for a little comment from you two individuals on that.
Well, I'm very pleased that you single this out, because I think all of us on the Commission are very proud of this recommendation, because it came from some very interesting intellectual disputation on the Commission. Because there were some of us who were sympathetic to the idea of a national identity card, and others that were very concerned about the privacy and civil liberties issues. And we believe we came up with what is as near to a perfect solution as you can with this national standard, because this is not a national identity card. It keeps in the states the responsibility for those documents and for the administration that goes behind that. There will be no national identity card. Yet it gives all the security benefits that a national identity card would give. And it doesn't have to be enforced by the federal government. If there are federal standards, it becomes enforced by the insurance industry and by private industry. If a state doesn't adhere to national standards, insurance rates are going to be a lot higher. Similarly, we recommend the adoption of national standards for building safety and fire codes and so forth. Similarly, the government, federal government, doesn't have to enforce it. It gets enforced by insurance underwriters and private industry. So we're very pleased with that, and we hope that it will be enacted.
Yeah, I mean, I actually would have gone further with the recommendations. I mean, I just, you know, for all those folks that are worried that the national identification card is going to impinge on your privacy, I mean, get rid of your credit cards first, you know, stop using a public email second, don't travel anymore third, and then tell me what the hell you think of it. I mean, the problem is we've given away so much of our privacy already without knowing it, and the trouble is, absent our capacity to, in a much more sophisticated way, tell who that small fraction is. No more than 1%. In fact, it's less than 1% of the 500 million visitors to the United States of America, we believe, have criminal intent. And the trouble is, they're slowed down a bit, but it's the 499 million others that are slowed down that cause us to basically impose upon ourselves more regulatory costs than we ought to, and more regulatory delays, et cetera, et cetera. So, I mean, this is about as far as we could go on a commission. But I just tell you, on the Democratic side of this commission, there was enthusiasm to push this envelope even further.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Mr. Tierney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just as the members of the family who are here today and all that they represent have turned their their personal pain into public service, and we thank them for that. I want to add my remarks to the commission members, the two people that are here before us, to thank them for their public service. You've done a great public service to the country, and we all appreciate that. There's no reason in my mind, having looked at all the exhaustive work that the commission's done to date, that we couldn't have in place by September 11, 2004, on the anniversary date, some legislation to move us forward. And I really hope that this Congress, the majority, takes a direction on that, and certainly we'll work with them to get that done. In your report, you had a strong desire for a national intelligence director, had control over budgets, the ability to approve and submit nominations for the heads of initial agencies, a counterterrorism center that had responsibility for operational planning. I think all of those things make absolute sense, but I think they also demand incredible oversight, which is a point that you've both made today. In your report, you give two suggestions of how we might do that. One is a joint House-Senate Committee for Intelligence, and the other is, of course, one committee in each body designated toward that goal with combining authorizing and appropriation powers. What's the preference, and why?
Well, it's most unfortunate. From my standpoint, very fortunate. You found the two.
Is your microphone on, Senator?
It is, yeah. The two people, the strongest advocates of the joint committee, are sitting before you today. So when we say what are the preferences, we're going to leave out the preferences of the other commissioners as we respond, because we favor the joint committee. I favor the joint committee because I think it's the strongest of the options. It gives Congress a stronger play. It gives Congress the strongest possible play. If you go back and look at the Joint Atomic Energy Commission model, the critique that was the loudest and eventually shut it down was that Congress was treading on the privileges of the executives more than it should. In this area where classification is the rule, you don't know what's going on. Congress has to have a strong committee. I would, regardless of which option you pick, though, Congressman, make sure it's written into law. Don't do it with congressional resolutions. No matter what you know, what the critics of the CIA will tell you, the men and women who work there follow the law. And they're just a little less persuaded of a congressional resolution. Secondly, require full and complete accounting. Require that in the statute. And especially if it's in law, it will be done. And the third thing is, because it's classified, because you don't have the oversight, whichever model you pick, require in law that the committee issue a public report once a year that's not classified, that lets people know what the status of these agencies are. Are they funded well enough? Where's the weaknesses? Where's the strengths, et cetera, et cetera? Get something out there that's public. The principal reason I think that Congress may find the Joint Committee appealing, however, and it's a very important one. Again, I was on the Appropriations Committee, and I know that combining authorizing and appropriating, you could get in the Senate, you could probably get 60 people privately tell you that that's a great idea. But the only people who are going to vote for it when it comes to the floor are people who are, A, not a member of the Appropriations Committee, or, B, hope to get something from the Appropriations Committee the rest of the time in the Senate career, which is probably less than 10. So what I believe you can do to accomplish that end is, again, in statute, require that the committee have representations from the Foreign Relations Committee, the Armed Services Committee, Judiciary, and I would say Defense Appropriations as well. We have additional language that keeps as much as possible the politics out of it. One of the things I heard earlier, our commission had power because we had subpoena power, and it was real subpoena power. Tom Kaine was willing to use it, and we got access to documents, we got movement, we got things that we wouldn't. This isn't a whack on President Bush. President Clinton probably done the same thing. No matter who the president is, who the executive leadership are, they're going to say we have executive privilege. You can't come and look at these things. So that subpoena power and the willingness to use it, if you got around in the chamber and you got it on safe all the time, nobody's going to be afraid of you. So in this particular case, you've got to take as much as possible the politics out of it so that subpoena means something to the executive branch.
Yeah, I totally agree with Bob, and I'm a year older than he is, so I go all the way back to actually dealing with the Joint Committee on Atomic Energy when I was on Kissinger's staff and when I was Deputy Director of the Arms Control Agency. It was a powerful committee. It was very searching and probing, and it got the issues out before the Congress and provided tremendous guidance to the
executive branch. It was almost a perfect model, in my judgment, of how the equal partnership between the two branches were, and it attracted people like Mel Price and Scoop Jackson and Craig Hosmer, and so I am equally enthusiastic with that as the proper solution.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Chairman, sure. I'm going to make a general point earlier about a comment. I appreciate there's been a lot of public attention faced putting pressure upon you all to hold hearings during the one of the most unfortunate names that you all have, the American people have, to refer to a time off as recess. You know, you guys need a vacation. You need to get away every now and then. I mean, one of the things we discovered is, had more of us read Tom Clancy, we might have been able to figure this out. Had more of us read Black Hawk Down or seen the movie, we might have understood that Bin Laden was either directly or indirectly responsible for shooting down our helicopters on the 3rd and 4th of October of 1993. I mean, part of the problem is that you are so pressed for time, constantly getting briefings, constantly reading the stuff that's coming through your inboxes, that when we say failure of imagination, that's what happened to all of us. And so, I mean, one of the unfortunate things is you've had a lot of pressure to help hold these hearings during research, which is, God bless you for doing it, for being willing to do it. But take some time off. Rename it to vacation. Say, you know, we need vacation, too. We got to go away and shut down and throw our cell phones away and our Blackberries away and not make contact with anybody other than the fiction that we're going to take with us and read.
Thank you. You have as much time as you need here. If you want more time, you can have it on that scope. Mr. Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I do want to thank you for holding this hearing on this important issue. And I want to thank the family members for their effort to continue to focus on advocating for issues that will make America safer. And I want to thank the commissioners for their effort in putting together a bipartisan commission report and their efforts to continue the recommendations in a bipartisan manner. One of the questions earlier, I think, inadvertently diminished the President's call for a national intelligence director, focusing on the word of coordinate. And I just for a moment, for the record, wanted to state what the President said. I have in front of me his statement from that day where he called for the national intelligence director. And he says, the national intelligence director will serve as the President's principal intelligence advisor and will oversee and coordinate the foreign and domestic activities of the Intelligence Committee. Under this reorganization, the CIA will be managed by a separate director. The National Intelligence Director will assume the broader responsibility of leading the intelligence community across our government. Of course, we all have to wait for the final specifics of what we're going to receive in that recommendation, but I didn't want the record to reflect a diminishing of what the President's efforts were. Senator Kerry, twice today in listening to your testimony, you've said things that relate to how I've felt in reading the report. And one, you said that in reading the narrative, it'll take you back to where you were that day and give you really the commitment of moving forward on these issues. On that day, I served as mayor for the city of Dayton. Our city had, the prior month, had a weapons of mass destruction terrorist response exercise upon the urging of one of our city commissioners, the late Lloyd Lewis, who thought that we as a community needed to be prepared for this looming threat. Attorney General John Ashcroft attended that event. And in reading the 9/11 Commission report, I was struck by that your recommendations were very similar to the recommendations that came out of our Dayton Domestic Preparedness Action Report on what was needed for our first responders. Those recommendations were for issues of training, protection equipment, intel on the local level, interoperability and command structure. And I know our chairman of the National Security Subcommittee, Chris Shea, is similarly before the September 11th event had held hearings on the needs of our first responders. The second thing that you had said was the issue of the statement by the terrorists of we have planes and the time period within which the Department of Defense was able to respond, in fact not respond. Assuming that we put all this intelligence structure together, intelligence only provides us knowledge, knowledge of which we have to take some action with, and assuming that a terrorist event is occurring or unfolding, both our first responders and our Department of Defense are going to need to have the resources necessary to be able to protect us and to work through a casualty and crisis. In looking in the report, it notes that at 8:25 a.m. was the first notice of the hijacking. At 8:46, F-15s were scrambled. At 9:25, they were over New York City's airspace. At 9:39, the Pentagon was attacked. So my two questions relate to, if you could comment further and expound on your issues that you saw in the resources and the needs of our first responders, and also, secondly, on the issue of our ability for the Department of Defense to have a national defense system that can respond if we do have intelligence of an unfolding event.
Well, you know, first of all, I think there's significant vulnerabilities that are still here. And as a former mayor of Dayton, you're apt to have a greater sense of urgency in coming to terms with the training needed to prepare first responders. I mean, you can't just put an ad in the paper and hire somebody and bring them in. All of a sudden, Mary or Jim or Sue can do the work. They got to be trained. If you want them to be effective against a potential biological weapon, you know, they've got to be trained to do it, let alone all the additional things that you have to do to be able to identify somebody who could be a suspect or to try to deal with the crisis once it starts to unfold. So there's a huge amount of training that's required. My experience with law enforcement is it's the one area that oftentimes gets shorted. It's hard to do. It's hard to constantly allocate the more money that's necessary for police and fire, and in our case in New York, Office of Emergency Management personnel, to keep their skill level up. And I would, Congressman, I really would urge you to look at I'm now trying to pronounce General Honore's name a second time. I hope I got it right the second time. He produced a memorandum for the record. He was, at the time, he was SYNC of NORTHCOM, a commander-in-chief of NORTHCOM. And it's a terrific memo because he's talking exactly about what you're talking about, I think, which is the first responder is the first line of defense. And what I was talking about when I was talking about this agony of listening to the American Airlines here, well, we have planes, is the issue of computer interoperability. And Honore deals with it very, very passionately and very clearly that he believes we're still headed towards a train wreck. The second individual that I would urge you to talk to, I would call into your offices. Not, I don't want to recommend that you bring him here in a hearing. That'll the last thing I want to do. The woman who led our team in Homeland in the border security, Susan Ginsburg, because Susan talks passionately and with great capacity about the shortcomings that we have again in training our personnel so they're prepared to do the job, and talks as well to Congressman Miller's point earlier that we have significant vulnerabilities at the border. Dealing with identification, that we have significant vulnerabilities still remaining with people out there having to make a decision that don't get the intelligence about that they need to make a decision on the spur of the moment. So, I mean, the fact that you're former mayor of Dayton, I think, prepares you enormously well to help other members of Congress figure out what those first responders have to do, because they're the ones that we're going to rely upon the most to keep the country safe, or God forbid, to handle the next crisis.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Lynch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, at the outset, I just want to thank you and Mr. Waxman for your promptness in responding to the 9/11 Commission report. Commissioner Lehman and Senator Kerry, I'd also like to thank you again and extend our gratitude, join the echo of the chorus up here, for the great efforts of your commission and yourselves personally on behalf of our country. Today's hearing offers the first opportunity for the House of Representatives to review the various proposals, both structural and policy-oriented, set forth in the 9/11 Commission final report. And I would just like to respectfully urge my colleagues in weighing these proposals to abide by the bedrock principles upon which our nation was founded, namely our government's responsibility and obligation to ensure the basic security of our people, as well as maintaining the delicate balance of the delicate system of checks and balances that guarantees our government's accountability to our people, and also, of course, a profound commitment to safeguarding the civil liberties that have come to be inseparable from the American way of life. To this end, in consideration of the 9/11 Commission's recommendations, I think we must dedicate ourselves to dividing a national counterterrorism policy that truly promotes information sharing and cooperation and, above all, accountability, as both of you gentlemen have testified today. And I would agree with others who have noted that the 9/11 Commission and yourselves in particular have demonstrated to the Congress of what a shining example bipartisanship can accomplish, and that's reflected in your report. I think all of us here are committed to developing an effective counterterrorism policy, regardless of where those recommendations may come from, whether it's the Commission or the Congress or the administration. And lastly, I would be remiss if I did not say to the families of those loved ones who were lost on September 11th that we thank you for your persistence and your loyalty and your dedication throughout this process. You have contributed greatly to this process, and it is my only hope that the weight of your sorrow will in some way be lightened by knowing that it is shared by both your neighbors and your nation. My question to the commissioners is simply this. This committee has previously investigated going-ons at the FBI and the Boston office, and we found during that investigation that there was an institutional, a cultural resistance to information sharing. We found that intelligence was actually the currency of career advancement for many of those FBI agents and supervisors. And is there one proposal, is there one formulation in your own minds that'll break down that resistance to information sharing that we have seen, at least in the FBI, and I believe is probably prevalent through all of these intelligence agencies?
Oh, this was one of the most long considered issues that we debated and thought about and took testimony on. It certainly was a contributing factor to 9/11. It's a deep cultural reality that good law enforcement people do not share evidence. It's ingrained in their professionalism, and it's needed in the law enforcement community. That is what makes it so difficult to blend or to share intelligence gathering and analysis on the one hand and law enforcement on the other. We thought very hard about creating an independent agency, an independent domestic intelligence agency on the MI5 or some other similar model like Australia or Canada has. We ultimately decided not to recommend that, but to recommend something that is, we think, neatly addresses exactly the problem that you found in Boston and that we found endemic in the domestic intelligence problem in the FBI. We are recommending a semi-autonomous service within FBI that is protected by the NID, that has the either the executive assistant director for national security and for intelligence, perhaps combined in one strong deputy director of FBI, that is dual-hatted to both the National Intelligence Director and to the FBI director, so that we retain the strengths of the connections of the FBI with the local law enforcement community, which is one of the great gatherers of domestic intelligence. And we keep the protections of civil liberties that the Justice Department provides. Yet we protect that intelligence function within FBI from exactly the dominance of the law enforcement culture of no sharing and of case development and so forth, rather than the sharing culture of intelligence analysis. That is another reason why this is all of a piece. If we proceed with the National Intelligence Director and do not give him hiring and firing authority over that FBI intelligence deputy and give him or her that authority over the budget and appropriations for the FBI intelligence function, then you have not really made much difference. You have not brought FBI into the fusion of our intelligence.
Thank you. We were very impressed. The commission was very impressed. I don't think I'm speaking. John can shake his head if I'm wrong, that we're very impressed with the progress that Director Mueller has made in a relatively short period of time to change that culture. Part of the culture is just understandable human nature. I mean, I don't want to tell you something because I'm afraid you're going to screw me with it.
You'll get credit for it.
I will get credit for it.
That's right.
But there's also another one that I There are times when secrecy doesn't equal security. There's times when secrecy equals the opposite. It makes us less secure. 90% of the foreign policy stuff that we get today to make decisions that you get today, you get from open sources. And the more we keep these things secret, the less debate we had. In my view, the reason we didn't identify bin Laden as public enemy number one prior to 9/11 is we kept the details about who he was secret.
Right.
After 9/11, the full story's out there.
Right.
And 75% of what we knew about bin Laden we knew in 1997, 90% we knew in 99, we knew 100% by 2001. We kept it secret, in my view. It made it exceptionally difficult for what we needed to do to reduce that threat.
Thank you. One very brief anecdote, if I could be brief.
Very brief. In the 93 World Trade Center, the Justice Department had to turn over to the Defense Council the names of the co-conspirators that intelligence had gathered. It went straight to bin Laden, but they could not share it with CIA.
Amazing. Very interesting, your responses. At this time, the chair would recognize Judge Carter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, I want to thank you, like everyone else here, for a really exceptional piece of work here. The bipartisanism is fantastic in this town, and I commend you for it, and I'm going to treasure this. And I'm going to try to couch questions that I got back home that I think we were. And one of the first questions I want to ask you is, we are in a war on terrorism. Can we lose this war on terrorism? And what would be the results of losing the war on terrorism to the American people? What do they expect to win from the? When would they say we win in the war on terrorism? Because the concept of war in the American people is not fitting what we're doing, and I think your report does fit what we're doing.
Well, Congressman, first of all, I presume the home is not.
Senator, could I ask you to put the mic? It works better.
Help me a little bit. You said when you go back home, I can tell it's not New Hampshire, but.
Well, I'm from Texas. Okay. I mean, you know, we take war real seriously in Texas.
The first thing I'd say, Judge, is I think a war on terrorism is inappropriately named. Terrorism is a tactic. I mean, it would make as much sense for us to declare war on zeros after December 7, 1941. Terrorism is a tactic. It's used by individuals to try to accomplish some objective. Now, it's hard to get your head into that, but that's what's going on here. And one of the more controversial things that we dealt with, and you'll see it in the report, we use the language. We believe that what we're dealing here with is radical Islamic jihadists who have made the decision, in this particular case, they made the decision that killing Americans is the most important thing to do. They've targeted Americans. Now, they've spread, and they've hit Spaniards in Madrid. They've gone beyond that. But the thing that made bin Laden unique was his decision to say, we're not going to try to destabilize Pakistan or Saudi Arabia or other Muslim nations. We're going to try to destabilize the United States of America by taking this tactic right to the head of the snake.
So then would you say their purpose is to kill Americans, which they have declared, and by killing Americans make us reach a point where they control policy in this country by taking actions of terrorism?
Yeah, I think there's a combination of things. I mean, first of all, they said, well, you're all going to go to heaven and hang out with virgins for eternity. If bin Laden believed that, he'd be sending his kids, and he's not. So it's apparently a device that works from time to time. But as I said, if you examine terrorism, especially in the 90s, it's been developed in very sophisticated ways. How do you disguise explosives on your body, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I believe you got to go to the ideological argument that underlies it. That's why I said earlier, to look at the Ramzi Youssef statement and compared to confronted by Judge Duffy's statement, I think you get the battle right there. And we can't be unafraid to argue that argument, that central argument that you hear Youssef using in trial. It's wrong, it's deadly, it's cowardly, put whatever you want on there, but you got to get to the argument itself. In my view, the only way to confront it successfully is to understand that you may never get to a perfect world where we're never vulnerable to terrorism. That's not likely to happen, in my opinion. Secondly, I think you've got to understand that
that vigorous military and law enforcement effort has to be used. We had an interesting exchange earlier with Congressman Kucinich over this thing. Bin Laden doesn't, these guys don't sit around and say, geez, what about civil liberties and what about the Geneva Convention and so forth. They've got to be vigorously pursued and relentlessly pursued, because if they feel like they're not going to be, you know, we're going to apply moral relativism to what they do, then I think the game is over. Secondly, thirdly, I think we do have to have, what do you call it, diplomacy or a debate over the ideas or whatever. We can't paper over these arguments. And the last thing, I think the United States of America has to continue to say that democracy, that free markets can provide you with an opportunity agenda. And we've got to show that it can. And whether that's trade policies or advocating good safety nets or whatever it is, if democracy doesn't make life a little bit better for the individuals who are inside of that democracy, we got a heck of a problem. We can't ask our law enforcement and our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines to fight this battle. If, for example, in 2006 the Farm Bill comes up, and we say we want business as usual, just to put it right, like I think it is. Now that may not sell back down in your congressional district in Texas. I don't know, but we can't, I think, win this unless we can honestly say to the world that democracy and free markets can be a vehicle to make your life a little bit better, regardless of where you live on this planet.
Mr. Chairman, may I have just a little bit extra time?
The gentleman's time has run out. Is that okay
to go on with us?
Thank you. At this time, we'd recognize Chris Van Hollen from Maryland. Thank you.
And thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank both of you gentlemen for your incredible service to our country. And I, too, want to thank the families of the 9/11 victims for everything you've done for our country in making the commission possible. Secretary Lehman, I was encouraged by your comment that your recommendations are not a Chinese menu and that the devil is in the details. And I ask that you continue to evaluate proposals, whether they come out of the White House or the Congress in the days ahead, to see if they meet that test, because I don't think it's partisan in any way to ask you to evaluate those proposals, whether they be out of the White House or out of the Congress. And I thank you for that. There's a line in your report on 406, page 406, that says the most serious disadvantage of the NCTC is the reverse of its greatest virtue. And you go on to say that in fighting this war against Islamic terrorism, we may have to concentrate more power in a certain entity, but we may concentrate too much power in one place, and therefore you call for checks and balances. And I want to ask both you gentlemen with respect to your observations and recommendations for the Congress, because my observation, Congress is very good at telling other people how to change themselves and reform themselves, but it does not have as good a track record when it comes to making reforms of itself. And Senator, both of you, I'd be interested, Senator Kerry, you mentioned the challenges you had with the Armed Services Committee and others during your service in the Senate. I'm interested in your advice as to how you create pressure within this institution to create some of those changes, number one. Number two, in addition to the changes you recommended, it requires the political will of the Congress to exercise that accountability. And, you know, you mentioned the subpoena power you had. The fact of the matter is, in the last couple of years, the Congress has not issued any subpoenas with respect to federal government agencies. And it gets to the question, I don't mean to this be partisan, because it could happen whether you had Democrats in control of the White House and the Congress or Republicans in control of the White House and the Congress. But the fact of the matter is, we need, it seems to me, as an institution, the Congress, to strengthen and see our role as an equal, co-equal branch of government, and not necessarily see ourselves as someone who's endorser or a cheerleader of all the policies that come out of the executive branch. And I only mention the subpoena issue because I think it's a reflection of the fact that Congress has maybe not exercised its full powers. And I ask for your observations on that. And the final question I have, it relates to the other part of what I see as intelligence failures. You examined intelligence failures dealing with 9/11. We, of course, have a number of groups that are looking at the issue of weapons of mass destruction and failures in intelligence or oversight of intelligence or interpretation of intelligence in that regard. And my one concern with some of your recommendations is the very things that may lend yourself to supporting a good response to the intelligence failures with regard to 9/11, I would ask you gentlemen whether they could exacerbate the intelligence failures with respect to weapons of mass destruction, in that you would have more homogeneity, more cookie-cutter approaches if you have one director, whether that would create additional pressures for everyone to salute and say, yes, sir, we agree with your analysis, as opposed to having different centers of analysis.
Well, I'll take the last part of that and let Bob deal with the first part. I think that homogeneity is something we absolutely must get away from. Time and again through our investigation, we found that groupthink in the community prevented imaginative perception of what the real threat was. We think that the recommendations we're making here, the system that we're recommending, ensures competitive analysis, not homogeneity, not agreement. When there are going to be national intelligence estimates, there need to be dissenting views in those intelligence estimates, when there are, and there usually are. DIA is very likely to have a differing perspective on some aspects of the same facts than CIA. And we want to make sure that the senior leaders, where there is honest differences of perception and analysis, they get to see them, that it's not an enforced consensus. One of the tremendous things about our report is, I'm sure as you read it, this is not a ground down homogeneity of view. It's a sharp-edged report with a lot of bold statements and facts in it. Yet we reach unanimity on it. That is what we've got to get. And to do that, you've got to have someone who ensures that the environment is such that people aren't afraid to speak out, that there is entrepreneurial spirit by analysts, and that that there's a willingness to take risks.
Well, honestly, I forgot what the first part was.
Senator, I need you to talk in that mic more.
Your experience, how you would propose the Congress go about enforcing your recommendations? I mean, what would you do as a member of Congress, is there an institutional problem when, do you sense that Congress has in any way lost its ability to, well, its traditional role of acting as a separate branch of government with respect to national security oversight?
This is a repeat of the same question, but the gentleman's time's up.
I think that based upon my own experience, I think there is a tendency to yield ground on national security when ground shouldn't be yielded by Congress. I think, though, there's to hit the one issue that I've talked about several times. In this area, it's even more difficult because it's all classified. I mean, you'll see ferocious debates going on in the open press about whether or not our military is at the readiness levels that they need to be at. There's no such debate going on in intel. None. Earlier, one of the members of this committee made a reference to the failure to detect the Indian nuclear detonation. We detected it the year before. We missed it by a hair the second time. We say, wait a minute. Vajpayee campaigned on a promise to detonate a nuclear weapon. You know, we shouldn't need the CIA to tell us he's going to do it. He promised to do it, unless we expect in India they don't keep their promises or something. I don't know. Thirdly, I say, find those areas where you're doing good work and do more of it. I mean, as you know, oftentimes it's somebody in a position of power that wants to make the government work better. That you're not going to see them out in the press. I mean, right now in intel, I think Senator Inouye and Senator Stevens are doing exceptional oversight on Defense Appropriations Committee. Care about the subject matter. You never see it out in the press. And as a consequence, I trust that the job is getting done. In this case, I believe that unless Congress changes the law on intel to create a much, much stronger committee than you currently have, I think you're always going to be frustrated. And lastly, let me say, I don't really think that we should be extended for 18 months. I don't think it works for us to be extended for 18 months, even if I had 18 months to give the task. Because in many ways, we were doing what now Chairman Shays, who's about ready to gavel me down, was trying to do with this committee. This committee can do oversight of the intelligence agencies, where you see failure happening, and I think can be a very substantial force to make sure that these changes occur.
Thank you, Senator. At this time, the Chair would recognize Marsha Blackburn from Tennessee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your patience and time in being here today to talk with us. We appreciate the report and appreciate your working with us through this. It's interesting listening to you talk about the need to fix the committee structure, to fix the vulnerabilities with immigration, the importance of not just moving around the organizational chart, Mr. Lehman, as you had said, and the need for our intelligence director or czar, whatever the name be, to have control of budget appropriations of the technology protocol. And in listening to all of this, I feel that what I'm hearing you say is that through the decades, government has grown far too bureaucratic, far too unable to respond quickly or in an effective and efficient manner, that the process is far too bureaucratic, and that instead of just shifting power around and reorganizing, that you feel we need to go about recreating a different way for government to work. And I guess in all of this that we're paying a price for underfunding intelligence through the years. And one of my questions is very similar to some you've had, how you would envision this agency working without the traditional constraints of government that we address each day. And because I know some of the questions I'm going to get from my district are where Fort Campbell, much of Fort Campbell is located, is if some of our military intelligence units would be answering to the Secretary of Defense or to the intelligence czar. So I know that I'm interested to hear your take on how this would operate without those traditional constraints of bureaucracy. I also, Mr. Carey, I would, in responding to that, I noticed on page 25 of the executive summary, you talk about the proposed need for reforms and to speed up the nomination process. And you've served in the Senate. You've served as vice chairman of Senate Intelligence. And I know that you brought your background of some of the successes and failures in that committee to your view on the commission and use that kind of as background. And I would like to know how you think that we could speed up that nomination process with the rules of the Senate allowing a single member to stop the process from moving forward, and if you had any thoughts on that. And Mr. Lehman, if you would first address how you would approach the structure, and then Mr. Carey, how you think we could speed the nomination process there.
Thank you. Yes, we are not recommending a structure that would not have the traditional constitutional restraints, and congressional oversight and the committee reorganization is a major part of that. But it will also be subject to each of the agencies that make up the intelligence community, their own inspector generals, their own internal controls, and their own oversight within the executive branch. But all good corporations have to regenerate themselves, have to go through re-engineering. What has transformed the productivity of American industry is constant improvement, total quality, lean manufacturing, which is a cultural change that you never leave the organization alone. It's constantly changing and improving. The government tends not to go through those kinds of renewings and re-engineerings. But when they do, they have shown, the government has shown, that they can create the same kind of innovation and new energy and new ability to deal with the modern world, just as corporations can. That's what we're recommending, a re-engineering of the government process to break up the concrete layers of bureaucracy that have ossified over the last 60 years, to take apart the vertical stovepipes that have built up between the agencies to prevent the sharing. So we don't see this either necessarily as a funding issue. You will look in vain for large declarations that we've underfunded intelligence over the years. Certainly there have been periods in the last 10 years when parts of intelligence, for instance human, have been very underfunded, because I'm sure very few of you have been collared by lobbyists for human. Yet I would be willing to bet you've all had visits from lobbyists from satellite manufacturers and other intelligence collection technologies. So there have been gross imbalances. As to the service, what we're recommending here, first of all, the Naval Intelligence and the Service Intelligence Corps are among the best in the intelligence community. They have their own esprit de corps, their own training program, and their own professionalism. They report to Defense Intelligence Agency as well as the Chief of Naval Operations, and they in turn report to the, in theory, but not in practice, to the Director of Central Intelligence. Now they will be part of an integrated yet decentralized intelligence community, each with its pockets of excellence under a National Intelligence Director.
Well, I mean, you know, changing the rules of the Senate having to do with one person being able to put a hold on a nomination is exceptionally difficult to do. And I think, as well as almost all the recommendations that we've made in our report, they're all difficult to do. They all have real problems and barriers in front of them. There are areas, for example, in funding, that where funding is the answer. And I've dealt with deficits the whole time I was in the Congress, practically, so I understand how difficult it is. But if you look at our border security recommendations, the U.S. visit program, to have it fully implemented by 2010, it's just too darn slow. There's some management weaknesses that have to be addressed. There's still some oversight lapses and where secrecy is a barrier. There's additional investigation that has to occur. We just ran out of time. We couldn't get to it. And there are some changes in the law, all of which have problems attached with it. I just urge you to get into this narrative. 19 guys hijacked 4 commercial aircraft on the 11th September using box cutters and legal knives. And it wasn't even a close call. All the defenses that were put up against them, all the security measures that we have in place failed to prevent them from attacking the United States of America. It wasn't even close. If you look at the images at Dulles Airport that were released by, I guess, the lawyer who's bringing a case against somebody, if you look at those images, we saw those images and we didn't want to put them out there because we were concerned that it would give away some security issues. But if you look at those images, and my God, it looked like they could have walked on with practically anything that morning. And all of us, you know, almost need to, anybody who was here in the 1990s, we all sort of need to join hands and walk to the podium and say we screwed up. And in that attitude, understand, we might be doing it again right now. We presumed we had time and we were wrong. Every step of the way, you'd say, well, I think I have a little more time. Certainly, this can wait till some other time. Well, maybe we can get another study or something. If you find somebody saying, I don't want to yield privilege, which is what you're talking about with the Senate rule, I don't want to yield power, this is going to be too uncomfortable for me, I may no longer be chairman or whatever, then you've got an argument that you just have to turn to us, I think, probably, and say, you got to stoke the fire a little bit of the public so that we can do what we have to do.
Thank you very much. Mr. Ruppersberger?
Yeah, first, thank you for your service, and I want to thank the families also for all that we've done. I think the country really is learning a lot about what we need to do, and I want to thank the chairman and ranking member for having this hearing right now so we can get started. I think when you look at what we need and your recommendations, it's very important to have a national intelligence director. You have to start at the top. You have to have one boss. You have to have that boss who will hold other agencies accountable for their performance. But in order to do that, you also need budget authority. And I would hope that the President would listen to these hearings and understand that this is very important, just like he is the boss of the United States of America. We need to have that focus here. Now, I would like to talk to you about another phase. And let me ask you this, too. There was a group of members of the Intelligence Committee introduced H.R. 4104. That's the Intelligence Transformation Act, and that was in March. Did you have a chance to review that?
Yes, we did, and we've had quite a bit of dialogue with the sponsors and the staff, and continue to have. There were some good ideas, by the way, that were that have been incorporated in our recommendations.
And the reason I point that out, that's an existing bill that I would hope, in a nonpartisan way, we can review the elements in that bill so that we could build upon that, as you all have in the report. Now, one of the major issues, I think, is a deputy director of national intelligence. If you look at the way intelligence is made up, and I think, Senator Kerry, you referred to this, is that the Department of Defense, the majority of the resources go to the Department of Defense as far in the intelligence community. Now, if in fact you're going to have the teamwork integration, which is so necessary to be effective in intelligence, you're going to have the Department of Defense at the table. And I think this bill, H.R. 4104, created what they call a dual-hatted. And let me read to you and see if you agree with this provision in H.R. 4101. Deputy Director of National Intelligence. There is a Deputy Director of National Intelligence who shall be appointed by the President by and with the advice and consent of the Senate. The Deputy Director of National Intelligence shall also serve as Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence. Now, in order for us to pull together, we know the power of the Secretary of Defense, one of the most powerful positions in the world. Now, when you have that person at the table, and then you have a Director of National Intelligence without budget authority, and you have those two together, who's going to win? Well, I don't know, but I tell you, I would say the advantage going in would be the Secretary of Defense. We need to pull those groups in together. Would you be in favor of having a deputy director, dual-hatted individual, as it's stated in H.R. 401, to pull all of the agencies together so that we have one unit dealing with the issue of intelligence?
Yes, we support that, but we also support two other deputies as well. We believe that your proposal for a deputy that is dual-hatted to the Secretary of Defense and to the National Intelligence Director is an excellent idea and can pull together all of the agencies in defense. There also has to be hiring and firing shared between the National Intelligence Director and the Secretary of Defense. But that deputy should not have authority over domestic intelligence. There should be another equal deputy for domestic intelligence, and that should be the Deputy Director of FBI, who also should be dual-hatted. That is, the Deputy Director for Intelligence National Security should be dual-hatted to both the FBI Director and the National Intelligence. And the third should be a deputy for foreign intelligence, and that should be the CIA Director. So we've taken your idea and added to it the domestic deputy and the foreign deputy as well. We think that's essential.
Okay, getting back to my question though, do you think that by having that deputy director dual-hatted from Department of Defense will deal with the issue when there could be a conflict or a power grab, so to speak, between Secretary of Defense versus intelligence? Do you think that would be enough to rectify that issue?
It will be enough to ensure that this dispute gets in front of the President to decide.
Right. Okay, and that's what's important. How about you, Senator Kerry?
Well, I agree. So long as the National Intelligence Director has statutory authority over the appropriated monies and has statutory authority over hiring and firing, absent that, they simply are going to be too weak, and you're going to be right back where we are today. I mean, you're better off, in my view, with nothing than creating something that just adds one more impression that this person has power that they don't have. One more moment for them to come up and answer questions to Congress about things over which they have no responsibility.
Okay. I see my red light's on. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You know, if I could, Mr. Chairman, can I?
Sure.
I'm going to volunteer either in writing or if the next time you persuade me to leave vacation and come down here to testify before the committee. There's one area in this report that I care deeply about that's not mentioned. It does have to do with DOD and CIA, and that is we're recommending that the authority for covert operations be transferred to DOD. And if at some point you have questions about that, I think it's sort of the last step on jointness. And I think the exercises in Afghanistan and the exercises in Iraq demonstrate that this is a good move to make. It still gives CIA authority. But in my view, it'll dramatically improve the quality of those covert operations. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Platts.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Senator
Kerry and Secretary Lehman, appreciate your work and all of your fellow commissioners and your staff. Daunting task, and you've done it in a remarkable fashion. And both in the broad global strategy you've put forward as well as specific recommendations. My colleague talked to you about the standards for driver's license. I appreciate that type of detail because it's something that amazed me when I came to learn that majority, I believe, of our states don't require proof of legal presence in the United States to get a driver's license, yet it's one of the accepted forms of government ID, deemed that you're supposed to be here or allowed to be here. So that type of specific recommendation hopefully help us move some legislation that's out there and get some of these standards in place. The follow up the discussion with the previous member on the NID and the personnel authority. In your statements, you talk about NID having personnel and appropriation authority, but also the chief of the National Counterterrorism Center. Can you elaborate how that's going to interact in since the chief is going to answer to the NID, how their shared authority over personnel of these various agencies, you kind of envision that working?
Well, I think the Pentagon provides a good example. Standards for promotion and rank in each of the military services are different. You don't have to fly airplanes to get promoted in the Army. Each secretary of the department governs the personnel policies, but they have to conform to Defense Department standards. So you can easily take an 06 naval captain and assign him to a joint command in an Army commanded unit because there are common personnel standards to be met that allow that kind of joint assignment. Now, this is different than detailing, and it's an important point. Today, for instance, at the TTIC, the Terrorist Threat Intelligence Center, people are detailed from all the agencies, but their fitness reports are still being written by the people back at their home agency. That's a huge difference. When they're a person is jointly assigned, it's the person who, for instance, will be running the National Counterterrorism Center that will write the fitness report and really have a huge influence on whether that person from whatever agency they came from gets promoted or doesn't get promoted or gets assigned to a choice billet or doesn't get assigned to it.
So more accountability from the staff to the NIO.
But
the
more
chief
real
of the,
clout from right. by the National Intelligence Director. The key is currently the CIA director has exhortation capability and people sort of think he has authority, but he doesn't have authority. And so he can say, oh, let's cross-assign people. But if you don't have the authority to direct, mm-hmm. and if the person being directed doesn't do it, they get fired and replaced by that NID director. That's what we're talking about. Big, big difference.
One of the other areas you touch on in a broad sense is more public diplomacy and us doing a better job of kind of winning the battle on the front with the younger citizens, I guess, of the Muslim nations. Is there specific recommendations? One of your recommendations says, in a broad sense, where Muslim governments, even those who are friends, do not respect these principles, the United States must stand for a better future. Is there something specific, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, any of our allies that we should be looking at doing?
There are two that I want to draw attention to that I think would have enormous leverage. One is putting some money into schools in these areas. There is no alternative to for parents in much of Pakistan and the rest of the Indonesia, for instance, the rest of the Muslim world, if they want their children to have a better future, i.e. to learn to read and write, they have no alternative but to one of these jihadist madrasis. We should take the initiative, working with those governments, and put some money behind it to create schools that can teach usable skills, and it can be done at a very relatively low cost. Another is international broadcasting. It's pathetic the number of hours that we're on the air to just tell the truth in Farsi, in Urdu, in the various dialects of Arabic.
On the schools, is one of the challenges we have with we give a lot of money to the UN to then, but that doesn't come back to us as credit to those parents that the U.S. is helping their children. Do we need to do more unilateral partnerships with these nations?
Well, I mean the context here, I mean, this is how this is how great a job we've done. I mean, we saved a Muslim nation, Kuwait, in 1991. We saved Muslims in Mogadishu in 1993 from Pakistan, part of a UN peacekeeping force. We save a Muslim nation, Bosnia, in 1995. We save a Muslim nation, Kosovo, in 1999, and yet you go do public opinion polling in Muslim nations, and they don't like us. I mean, that's how lousy a job we've done of communicating to the Muslim world.
We've just liberated 50 million Muslims in two nations.
Exactly. There's another issue that I think is important. Look, when I graduated from high school, back when dinosaurs roamed the earth, 75% of the people on this planet were living in nations where democracy wasn't the rule. And now it's just the opposite. Even in China, they're beginning to see democracy at local levels. Not as much as I think they're going to need in order to deal with their economic challenges, but that's a separate issue. We've got to stop, and I hear it sort of creeping back as a consequence of the problems in Iraq, saying that democracy is not suited for you. It's a Western idea. Greece is not in the West as much as we like to think. It's much closer to Afghanistan than we are. So we've got to stop saying that democracy only works here. And we all know, all of us have either, those of us you are still in politics, when I was in politics, the most important thing is people need to know that democracy is making their lives just a little bit better, and their kids' life a little bit better, and their communities a little bit better. It's not very complicated. And if it isn't, they get really mad, and they throw you out of office. Well, we've got to stop saying, well, I know the Saudis, you know, every other word of the Saudis is reform these days. And we got to stop putting our arm around and say, well, we understand you can't really be democratic because you've got difficulties here and there and everywhere. We got to stop doing that because the people that are living in Saudi Arabia are mad because they don't have what we've got, right, which is the freedom to be able to throw people out of office when we don't like them. So I'm not suggesting that we kept in sort of a naive pie in the sky attitude that doesn't recognize that for many people democracy is one vote, one time. But I believe the most important thing for us in this battle of ideas is to say that democracy and free markets, as flawed as it is, as difficult it is to make it work, is the best way to make your life a little bit better and the life of your kids a little bit better and the life of your community a little bit better.
I agree 100%.
Thank you very much. Ms. McCollum.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to thank the commission for the work that they did. I learned a lot, either being in my kitchen in the morning, listening to your staff reports and opportunities when I had to watch the hearings on television. But most importantly, I want to thank the families. I think because of the families and the work that you did, the report that the commission generated that I've been reading again, and that a woman next to me on an airplane looked at it, and I said, you should read this. Oh, I don't know if I'd understand. I said, you should read this because you will understand it. It is written in a way that provides a wealth of information in a way that every American citizen, every family can benefit. And so I thank you both for the work product that you have. And she agreed with me. She could read it. She did understand it. She's going to buy a copy. In chapter 12 of the report, you say counterterrorism has become beyond any doubt the top national security priority for the United States. The report goes on to say, quote, the catastrophe threat at this moment in history is more specific than just terrorism. It is a threat possessed by Islamic terrorism, especially the Al-Qaeda network, its affiliates, and its ideology. The other day, the president was asked the question, in what way would his new structure, or looking at any new structure, prevent the kind of intelligence failings that preceded the war in Iraq? I'm very, very, very troubled by not having the type of intelligence failings in Iraq addressed clearly. We had the intelligence failings in 9/11 in Iraq. The president, when asked that question's answer to me was equally troubling. He quote, and let me just say to you, knowing what I know today, we still would have gone to Iraq. Prior to March, and that's the end of the President's quote, prior to March 2003, would Iraq have been defined a top national security priority for the United States based on this report's threat definition? Has the war in Iraq helped protect American citizens from the threat of Islamic terrorism when Osama bin Laden, Mr. Omar, and thousands of al-Qaeda operatives remain at large? How can the Congress and the President use what you have in place to prevent the intelligence failure of Iraq? Because it was a failure in intelligence for the reasons we did vote for some who voted to go to war, to go to war.
Well, I think that it was a blessing that the intelligence failures in Iraq were not part of our mandate. And we did not spend a great deal of time on those intelligence failures. And there is now a commission studying those. So I don't feel comfortable testifying as a commission member on that first part of your question. But the second part of the question, I feel very comfortable because what I've read in the newspapers and what those parts of the Iraq issue that have come before our commission's investigation, and there are a bit of that, make it very clear that this is of a piece with the failings that we found led up to 9/11. That this is a balkanized intelligence community that does not share, that does not have the ability within itself to prioritize what is important, as one commissioner said, unable to distinguish between a bicycle accident and a train wreck in terms of raw intelligence. It's remarkable, shocking, that the senior members of this Congress and of this administration first learned of the Iranian connections from us, not from the intelligence community. It was we, the 9/11 Commission, that dug this intelligence out that existed in the intelligence community, had been gathered, was sitting there, scattered around the intelligence community. We had to put it together, we the Commission. So that is a remarkable fact that just illustrates that we have a dysfunctional, balkanized intelligence establishment today. And the failures of the intelligence system in Iraq, in WMD, are entirely of a piece with everything else we've learned about the dysfunctions of this system.
Time.
I'll stick with John's answers as well. I mean, it was sort of outside of our the envelope, although it does get connected in one way for me, and that is that among the insights that I've taken away from the experience of being on this commission is that, and it's hard to deal with it, but it's true, and that is that for the United States, the homeland is the planet, and try as you might to say, no, it's just the continental United States, Alaska, and Hawaii, you're not going to get it done. If you're trying to deal with border security or immigration issues or whatever you're dealing with, you need the rest of the world to participate. When school children die in a fire in Bombay here a couple of weeks ago, it felt like I was in my neighborhood. When Spaniards were killed on the 15th of March, it felt like it happened to us. And one of the mistakes that we made, in my view, with bin Laden is as long as he was killing people over there, it wasn't as big an issue for us as it was when he killed people here. In January and February 1993, we had World Trade Center attack when six Americans were killed, and we had two Americans killed at CIA headquarters by a guy by the name of Kanzi. We tracked both of those guys down, brought them back to the United States, they stood trial, and they got justice. But when it was killing Americans in Somalia, when it was killing Americans in East Africa, when it was killing Americans at OPM Sang in Saudi Arabia, when it was over there, it didn't affect us as much. We didn't respond like we did when it was here. And among the things that I think where the Americans are going to have to get their head into, and it has lots of moving parts, is
that the homeland is the planet. And I understand that it imposes upon us a lot of responsibility and burden that we perhaps prefer not to have. But it's our burden that comes as a consequence of our wealth and our power and our capability.
Thank you very much, Ms. Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Once again, I want to echo what all my colleagues have said. I want to thank you for your expeditious and timely handling of such an important issue, and for the Commission. Thank you for your service. Thank you for creating a report that may be one of the most important publications of our age, and certainly for the relatives of those who were murdered in 9/11. We can't imagine the depth of your sorrow or pain, but thank you for channeling that loss into something very positive for policy for the future and protection of our country. My question, I want to revisit the last question just real quickly. I just want to clarify something. In all of the reports, sometimes it's been alleged that there was a politicization of some of the intelligence activities, and I just wanted to make certain you did not find that in the report. I did not find that in your findings. Is that correct?
That is not something that that particularly emerged as a finding of our investigation.
It is not a finding of the investigation, but if you ask.
Okay.
I need one of those that goes on automatically. I'm mechanically challenged. Look, I think the idea that somehow we're going to take politics out of intelligence, I mean, you'll fail to get it done. I mean, if I'm afraid of the dark and you elect me president, I'm going to bring that fear of the dark into my policies. You may and know that I'm going to. I'm just going to. And whether it's Bill Clinton or George Bush or Ronald Reagan or whoever it is, when they come into president to be president, the people in intelligence know what they care about, know what they're concerned about, and it's going to affect their attitude. What's necessary is to surround yourself with people who are really prepared to argue with you vigorously when they think that you shouldn't be afraid of the dark. That's what you need. Not that you can somehow cause human beings to behave differently. Then what human beings are going to behave, which is they want to make the boss happy.
I just wanted to clarify, I had not found that in the report. The point of my question, I actually have two questions. One, particularly when you look back at the report and you see your findings that say really basically from the 1980s, the United States, that terrorism had evolved and it presented a threat to our government that we weren't really ready to counter. And yet we've seen one of the largest restructurings of government in the federal government since the last half century. The report gives us a broad array of suggestions to reorganize the government across agencies, cooperations, and other issues. And the president signaled yesterday that he wanted to implement some of those through his administrative executive orders. When you look back and understand the urgency of implementing some of these issues and suggestions, but understanding the deliberations that are necessary. If we're going to move swiftly first, could you tell us what your three top recommendations are, what we should do immediately? And then my second question is more specific. On the CAPS issue, Senator Kerry, you've commented some in recent questions. In the 9/11 report, it cited that Mohammed Atta and several others of the 9/11 hijackers had actually been picked up by CAPS, so that I guess technology evidently was at least partially effective, but we didn't have procedures in place prior to 9/11 for follow-up. Now the Department of Homeland Security has been working on CAPS 2, which is a much more sophisticated screening program, but recently they decided to halt that work because of privacy concerns. And while I'm very concerned about our privacy, I'm even more concerned about being attacked by terrorists again. Do you think that the CAPS 2 was overly intrusive of our privacy, although it was really focused not at all it did not cite race. It really cited travel procedures and preferences. Do you think that we should continue on with CAPS 2? Do you think, just in view of protecting our homeland security, it seems like it shouldn't be too much to ask that we could track those. Amazon.com is allowed to track buying patterns for consumers, and it seems at the very least we could track travel preferences and behaviors of those who might be suspicious or be pointed out by CAPS too.
I'll answer the first part, which is the top three, briefly, the easy one, and Bob can answer the tough one. First, Congress has to reorganize. The reason the massive changes that Homeland Security were to have brought about have not been fully realized is that the Secretary of Homeland Security reports to 88 committees. He spends more than half his time up here on the Hill, which in itself is not a bad thing, but it is totally fragmented with no coherence in the process. It needs to be fixed. We've already talked at length about the need for the intelligence oversight to be fixed. So that's the number one. Second is to recognize the nature of this problem and the policy recommendations that we're making here on what to do. Third is to carry out the organizational changes, which start with the National Counterterrorism Center and the establishment of the National Intelligence Director and the dual hatting of his deputies. So those are my top three, and I think that reflects the priorities of the commission.
Well, I apologize. I'm not going to be very helpful because I'm not that familiar with the CAPS II refinements, what it attempted to do. But I do think that it's worth noting that we had two tremendous successes, human successes, in preventing people from coming into the United States and doing bad things. One of them was in your state, in Florida. And John, do you remember the name of the individual who?
Melendez, Officer Melendez.
I mean, he's and then a woman up in the state of Washington, up in during the Millennium Plots, prevented Rassam from coming across the border. I think fundamentally the problem on 9/11 is we weren't at a heightened state of alert, and we should have been. I mean, going back further, we let a guy declare war on us in 1996 and then basically operate with impunity for another half a dozen years. So as long as he was killing people over there, it wasn't as big a problem for us. But I think in addition not to being at a state of alert, the thing I think of when I think of CAPS, Congresswoman, is the huge amount of time and resources and effort it's going to take to train the men and women that are going to be necessary to do this work. Because for my money, it's the most important thing out there. We have 500 million visitors coming in and out of the United States every single year. That's a big number. And their job is to basically find, you know, the needle in the haystack. And they're not going to find it if they don't understand what intelligence is, if they don't have access to that intelligence, if they aren't trained up, et cetera. I mean, all of us who have the joy of flying experience this issue every single time we get on an airplane, of coming to terms with the fact that, you know, the guy may not know exactly what it is that he's doing, and he's, you know, checking you all out and so forth. So I think you've got to get the training done. And again, I'd urge you to look at the stuff that we had in the border security that Susan Ginsburg did for us, because that team got access to things. My guess is, as John said, my guess is, talking about the Iran issue, my guess is we got access to things that you haven't seen when it comes to border security and weaknesses and vulnerability and border security that you haven't seen to date. Yeah. And so
CAPS 1 worked. As you said, it identified six of the terrorists, but people were looking for explosives, so they were allowed through. CAPS 2 is much better, much more sophisticated. It's not perfect, and certainly civil liberties have to be protected, but we ought to get on with it. It's not perfect, but it ought to be implemented, because to put it on the shelf and suspend it because of sensitivities, we think is not supportable. We need to get on with it.
Thank you very much. And our last question, Ms. Watson.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. And I, too, want to add my thanks with my colleagues to the commission, the families, the staff. You've done a yeoman job. You've added your wisdom, experience to the volume of work that I think will go down in history as a major response. I'm sitting here listening, and I have to be reminded that we're spending time reorganizing the deck chairs on the Titanic and rushing swiftly towards the iceberg. We don't even know what the iceberg is all about. But you reference it, and I think the most pertinent part of your report appears in Chapter 12, What to Do in a Global Strategy. Who is our enemy? You know, your comments on terrorism. Well, where is terrorism? Who is the enemy? Are they in one location? I believe they live and work among us. I believe they're driving those taxi cabs here in the district. I believe they're in our institutions. And I truly believe they are smarter than we are. And so I think because of the work that you have put in to the commission, that we ought to do the following. We ought to approve all the recommendations. And the commission ought to stay in place as advocates for the rest of this decade. I also believe that we need to have a report on our risk assessment. I also feel very strongly that we need an independent citizens panel. These families that have worked with you minute by minute, side by side, including the media, ought to be on an independent basis, not attached to the executive branch or the congressional branch, so they can act out there in the public and see that we do the right thing. We must focus on our global strategy. You said it, both of you did, but I have to refer to Senator Kerry. You know, terrorism is global. And we live on this globe. That's the only globe we live on. And unless we understand how they think, unless we understand the ideology that says they don't practice what we think, so let's just kill them, we will get nowhere. We can build great arms, and we can go after their arms. That's not going to get it. So what we have to keep in mind is that we need to identify the mystic terrorist. We need to have people who look like them. And that's another thing. We need diversity in the State Department. We need diversity on them. People who share some of the same maybe ethnic background. And we need to get into their minds. And we need to show that we are a nation of laws and that we indeed can share, and that's what you have come up with. We must share. We must share in this institution that we're in. We don't do that. We, what do you call it, stovepiping? We're in two little stovepipes, you know, Republicans, Democrats. We're afraid to offer and share. So you said we have a tremendous opportunity. I think of the yin and yang. We have a tremendous opportunity to take this great tragedy that not only we face, but the world faces, and turn it around. It's going to take a decade or more to do. I would think that you ought to be paid because you're not going to be able to pursue your other careers. You two fine gentlemen, you know, it's going to take time, but I don't think you ought to meet daily. And I think you ought to be seen as the advocates for the plan that's going to help us survive on this globe. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'll take the comment if there's time. And may I have permission to submit my remarks?
Without objection, all members can submit statements for
Thank
the
you.
Record. You want to stay on forever, Bob, or?
Yeah.
End of the decade. I didn't see him jumping out of their seats, but. But thank Ms. Watson, thank you for your comments, and thank you. Let me just say, I think this has been incredibly informative. This has been a needed dose of reality, not just for American people, but for Congress. We get so partisanized and political up here sometimes, we can't reach a consensus on the Pledge of Allegiance. You did a great job. I just want to thank you.
Go on vacation now.
Yeah. You're my cover if anybody says anything. Finally, let me just say, you know, five Democrats, five Republicans from fairly partisan backgrounds coming together in a non-political atmosphere to reach a consensus on these issues. I feel confident that we will move ahead as expeditiously as possible, but you've both requited yourselves and the Commission well today. We thank you for your testimony and your service.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much.
I also want to extend my gratitude to the two witnesses. I think you've given us excellent testimony and set the good benchmarks for a successful legislation, and we're going to do all we can to help succeed, because I think you've given us the thoughtfulness and concrete proposals that I think are essential. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks so much. Committee will take just a minute recess as we move to our next panel.
In a moment, the next panel in the House hearing on the September 11th Commission's recommendations. We'll hear from family members, followed by U.S. Comptroller General David Walker. Then officials from the FBI, AT&T, and other agencies on the use of technology in combating terrorism. Tomorrow on C-SPAN's Washington Journal, political reporter Ed Tibbetts on campaign stops in Iowa by President Bush and John Kerry. Eliza Griswold on her New Yorker magazine article about the Pakistan-Afghanistan border. Then Reagan's National Security Advisor Robert McFarlane on his article about the creation of a National Intelligence Director. Washington Journal's live at 7 a.m. Eastern. Stay with C-SPAN tomorrow for more hearings on the September 11th Commission's report, with a focus on intelligence gathering from former NSA Director William Odom, State Department Counterterrorism Coordinator Kofor Black, and other counterterrorism officials before the House Select Committee on Intelligence. It's live starting at 9 a.m. Eastern here on C-SPAN. And that hearing re-airs tomorrow night, starting at 8. We continue now with testimony from three women who lost family members in the September 11th terrorist attacks. This panel is an hour and a half.
Thank you all for being here, and thank you for your patience. It's been a long day. We have two panels after this as well, but we are very excited about having you here today, and you're willing to come forward and testify before this committee. It's our policy that we swear all witnesses in before you testify, so if you just rise with me and raise your right hand.
They're still switched. They're supposed to stand. Yes. We're going to be sworn in.
Okay. Solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Thank you.
Sally, why don't we start with you, and we'll move straight on down. Your testimony was submitted last night. I read it. So your entire testimony is in here. You can take up to 5 minutes to read it, and then we'll have some questions. But again, I think all of the committee is grateful for what you've done after 9/11. We express our sympathy for your losses, but I think some good has come out of this, and your willingness to step forward and be leaders has made a huge difference. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
It's on. Push your button there.
Okay, there it is. Thank you. Chairman Davis, Ranking Member Waxman, Vice Chairman Shays, and members of the House Committee on Government Reform, it's an honor to be here today, an honor that I appreciate very much. My name is Sally Reagan-Hard. I'm the founder and chairperson of the Skyscraper Safety Campaign. I created this organization in memory of my son, Christian Reagan-Hard, a probationary firefighter who was lost at the World Trade Center on 9/11 with his entire engine company, 279, and they remain missing to this day. The goals of the Skyscraper Safety Campaign include advocating for a thorough investigation into the disaster of the World Trade Center, as well as making high-rise buildings safer in the future through improved building codes, design practices, and enhanced emergency response procedures and equipment. Today, we'd like to discuss some of the findings and recommendations of the 9/11 report. I'd like to focus on Chapter 9 and some of the recommendations in Chapter 12. Overall, I feel that the 9/11 commissioners and staff have provided us with a great amount of detail and analysis about the emergency response that terrible day. Their extensive text and notes give us new insights into what went right and what went terribly wrong that day. They are to be thanked and congratulated for their superlative and dedicated work, and they must also be thanked for the respect and honor shown to the victims and the family members. However, I do feel that some of the conclusions drawn in Chapter 9 are not based upon actual substantiated facts, but rather upon unsupportable opinions. One particular aspect of the report that is quite troubling to me and to my organization is a discussion relating to the evacuation orders of the North Tower on pages 322 to 323 of the report and the corresponding endnote number 209. It is alleged that many of the firefighters in the North Tower heard the message to evacuate but chose to remain in the building prior to its collapse. To the contrary, this issue of firefighter deaths is directly tied to the lack of radio communication capability in the World Trade Center on 9/11. This has been well documented in the post-9/11 McKinsey report, the New York Times, and numerous other publications and firefighter comments. Yet this theory that firefighters chose to die has been advanced by some public officials, undoubtedly hoping to deflect criticism for the inadequacy of the FDNY radios and for the absence of a functioning incident command structure in New York City on 9/11, which undoubtedly could have saved so many firefighters' lives, including my beautiful son, Christian. I take specific exemption to the section in the Commission report which states, quote, "In view of these considerations, we conclude that the technical failure of the FDNY radios, while a contributing factor, was not the primary cause of the many firefighter fatalities in the North Tower. I and my technical advisors of the Skyscraper Safety Campaign, which represent a large professional field of fire-related professionals and communication and evacuation specialists, have reviewed the substantiating documentation and have found it lacking. In essence, the report makes a very weak argument, such as, quote, it is very possible that at least some of these firefighters did hear the evacuation order, as well as the most curious statement that firefighters, quote, were likely to have known to evacuate. Such statements are not conclusive. Stating that firefighters refused to evacuate the building for whatever reason and disobeyed such an important order simply cannot be confirmed and is a disservice to their memory. These people are dead. We cannot ask them these questions. The questionable findings of Chapter 9 are based on interviews and transcripts which the families and the public have no access to. The information upon which these conclusions were based is secreted, is suppressed, and this information contains key knowledge that the families of the victims would like to have. Myself and other family members here today are part of the 45% of family members whose loved ones were never, ever identified. Not one single piece of DNA was ever found for my son and for 45% of the victims. If this information and this testimony that these commission's recommendations and findings are based upon, I'm asking that this be made public so that at least we can find out how these very curious conclusions have come to pass. I have to say that it may seem that it's not that important to you, this one aspect of firefighters not obeying orders, but I must say to you, to the families of the firefighters who perished that day, including myself and the mother of firefighter Sean Patrick Tallon, who is among the family members here today, we feel that the lack of radio communication capability was the primary reason that so many firefighters died. The fact is that their equipment betrayed them at the time when they needed it the most. The fact is well documented in a new book co-authored by a New York City Fire Department battalion chief, and this book is called Radio Silence FDNY. It provides a history of how these failed radios got into the hands of the entire New York City Fire Department on 9/11. Even today, nearly 3 years later, the fire department still does not have an adequately robust radio system that gives them the capability to talk in all high-rise buildings in New York City, in all subways, and in tunnels. This is not just a firefighter issue. This is an issue of public safety and grave concern for all, not only in New York City, but in other states that also can be a target of terrorism, and we don't know how emergency communication will work. I call on Congress today to hold hearings into the flawed 911 emergency communication system and the fire department radios of 9/11, as well as the failure of the City of New York to put useful radios into the hands of today's firefighters. You are the last hope to provide an unbiased, critical review of this significant issue. Another issue I'd like to discuss pertains to the report's analysis of the incident command system currently utilized by the City of New York. Just days prior to the 9/11 Commission hearings this past May in New York, the City announced the creation of a new citywide incident management system intended to meet an impending federal requirement. Unfortunately, SIMS is a fundamentally flawed command system in many respects, including its illogical split of hazmat responses between the NYPD and the FDNY, even in the case of a terrorist attack, and the lack of a single, clearly designated incident commander in many emergency responses. As a New Yorker living in this nation's number one terrorist target, I also have grave concerns about the amount of money flowing to New York City for anti-terrorism preparedness. We should be receiving a much larger piece of the pie, eliminating the pork barrel spending of the past. I agree with the 9/11 Commission and its desire to see that a risk and vulnerability assessment form the baseline for spending. I would further suggest that the likelihood of an attack play the predominant role in any risk vulnerability assessment. Regarding the Commission's recommendations, a review of Chapter 12 reveals that only three recommendations deal with all of the complex issues that surfaced in New York City and continue to haunt us to this very day. These three recommendations can be characterized essentially as mom and apple pie. They are too broad, and they are lacking the specificity to deal with the complex issues at hand. I would have hoped for many more specific recommendations dealing with each of the communications, incident command, and private sector emergency preparedness issue raised in this report. Once again, this is not just about New York City. These have ramifications for every other state or every other city in this country which could be a likely target of a terrorist attack. For example, the 9/11 Commission should have strongly critiqued the New York City's incident command system rather than just stating that, quote, emergency response agencies nationwide should adopt the incident command system. With all due respect to the Commission, most cities and states have already done this. New York was the only major city in the only state in this country which lacked an incident command structure on 9/11. Why not analyze New York City's current system and detail why it is so flawed, rather than just state, as the Commission stated, that it, quote, falls short of an optimal response plan? Clearly, more work is needed in this area. In closing, you may have noticed that I am wearing some medals today. My son earned these medals for obeying orders as a recon Marine sergeant during his 5 years of distinguished service in the United States Marine Corps before joining the fire department. When a Marine receives an order, he follows it. If told by a supervisor or a superior officer to evacuate the World Trade Center on 9/11, he and others would have done so, if only their radios would have worked. All of these predominantly young firefighters lost at the World Trade Center on 9/11, with rare exception, would have chosen life if only they were given the chance. Unfortunately, they and the rest of the 343 cannot testify before you today. I wear these medals to defend their honor, and in doing so, I once again reiterate the need for congressional hearings into the communications and radio failures of 9/11. I acknowledge the role of the first responders as part of the first casualties in this war on terrorism. Please, do not overlook the important problems still facing them today. The FDNY and the rest of our nation's emergency personnel are America's first lines of defense in this country. If they are not safe and well-equipped, how can they protect the public in case of another terrorist attack? Please help them and honor those who are gone by giving your attention to this most important matter. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Eckert.
Okay. Honorable Chairman Davis, distinguished members of this committee, ladies and gentlemen, My name is Beverly Eckert. I am appearing here today as a member of the Family Steering Committee for the 9/11 Commission. We very much appreciate this opportunity. We understand it is both a privilege and a responsibility. And we also extend our thanks to the commissioners and their staff for their tireless work and the cogent recommendations which are the focus of today's hearings. Most of all, we thank the American people for their interest and support of this process. Hundreds of thousands have purchased the Commission's report. Tens of millions have accessed the Commission's website to read for themselves the summary of what went wrong on September 11th and what we need to do as a nation to correct those failings. These astonishing numbers make it very clear that it can no longer be business as usual in Washington. This committee's presence here today is testament to that. There is no recess from terrorism. And because of the transparent way the Commission operated and the accessibility of their report in bookstores and on the internet, ordinary citizens are now well informed about the failures of our national security apparatus, and they are engaging in much needed debate about how our government needs to change to address those failures. This is democracy alive and at work. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, the roadmap is in front of you. There are 41 recommendations contained in the 9/11 Commission report. Neither the Family Steering Committee nor the American people will let those recommendations suffer the same fate as those of past commissions. There is no shelf on which they can be hidden. You and the rest of Congress are very much in the spotlight, as I'm sure you're all keenly aware, and you will be held accountable by the people for your actions or inactions, as will the White House. To help this oversight, the people's oversight, the Family Steering Committee will make the progress of legislation, executive orders, and agency initiatives available on our website. We will list co-sponsors of bills, as well as who voted for and against. Our hope is that legislation will be passed by unanimous consent after expedited hearings before the end of this year. As this process moves forward, we challenge you, election year notwithstanding, to resist pressures from lobbyists who might oppose reforms that add cost to their clients' operations. In terms of content, we respectfully require that every bill dealing with these recommendations mandate specific implementation steps and timetables to avoid the delays that characterize the regulatory route. Families who worked so hard for aviation safety improvements after the Lockerbie tragedy in 1988 understand this need all too well. We also require language in each bill that addresses funding and that appropriations with flexible earmarking promptly follow. We respectfully require that the bills submitted to Congress be unencumbered by amendments, the pork that so often is associated with controversial legislation. Lastly, we challenge the House and Senate to work together to draft complementary bills so that there will be no need for conferencing behind closed doors. The reforms needed to build a more secure nation must not be derailed. Nearly 3 years have passed since our nation's security was catastrophically breached, but not enough has been done since then to make us safer. During the 9/11 hearings, we heard from agency after agency the corrective measures had been implemented, only to learn from incidents reported in the news that security lapses are still rampant. The Commission report speaks of a failure of imagination in Washington, a failure to understand the threat and respond to it. Going forward, we need government officials who do have imagination, who can implement legislation that's creative and responsive and capable of addressing the challenges and threats of the 21st century. A National Counterterrorism Center and a Director of National Intelligence at the helm is at the heart of the Commission's recommendations. Yesterday, the President announced that he would support these two recommendations, but the DNI needs to have the necessary management, budget, and appropriations control. It's a critical element if they're going to succeed, and also, this control needs to extend to the Defense Department. Otherwise, the effectiveness of the DNI will be undermined. Be assured that the Family Steering Committee will be monitoring these important aspects. The report identifies Congress itself as being dysfunctional. We therefore call upon each of you to have the courage to be part of the solution, embrace fundamental change in the way the Congressional Committee oversight system operates. As in the days preceding the 9/11 attacks, the threat of terrorism is now high. This committee, Congress, and the President must act with great urgency. Upcoming elections must not overshadow these initiatives. These recommendations require your undivided attention. The American people will accept nothing less. Whatever the outcome in November, we expect that you, our representatives, will use your full terms of office productively. We fully support a special session of Congress to ensure that the momentum generated by these hearings will continue. We cannot afford a lame duck session to legislation still pending after the November elections. My husband, Sean, was trapped in the South Tower of the World Trade Center on September 11th, but he was able to reach me by phone. When the smoke and flames drew near and Sean knew he was going to die, he remained calm, speaking of his love for me and for his family. I will forever be in awe of the way he faced his final moments. In the days that followed, I felt somehow infused with his courage and strength, and that has helped me persevere through these difficult months. So many other family members were similarly inspired. Despite our private anguish, we shared a goal to make this country safer so that the deaths of 3,000 people would not be meaningless. Too many of us lost someone we cherished on September 11th. Too many of us also lost our faith in a government we had blindly trusted to protect the people we loved. After September 11th, the country reached out to families and asked what they could do to help us heal. We now have an answer. Help us make these recommendations happen. And our question to Congress, the President, and this committee is, are you willing to implement reforms before this year is ended and thereby restore our nation's faith in its government? The anniversary of September 11th approaches. What better way to honor the memory of those who perished than by enacting legislation this year which ensures that no other family member has to experience what we have endured? I hope I never see the day another widow has to walk in my shoes. The time to act is now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Eckert. Ms. Weiner.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you for inviting us to testify today, and thank you for holding these hearings. I'm truly honored to be here. My name is Robin Weiner, and I appear before you as a member of the Family Steering Committee, a board member of Families of September 11th, and most importantly, as the sister of Jeffrey Weiner, who was killed the morning of September 11th while working at his desk on the 96th floor of Tower 1 of the World Trade Center. As tragic as that day was for the victims, their families, and all of our country, America was united, strongly united, for months after the attacks. Sadly, that unity eroded quickly as response to the tragedy became political. In the months following September 11, 2001, the families began to advocate for the creation of a commission to investigate the terrorist attacks, with the goal of making whatever changes would be necessary to prevent another such attack. The American spirit that drives us to seek the truth has shown itself in the sales of the report, a bestseller by anyone's calculation. Unity and truth are vitally important, Mr. Chairman. They are very powerful forces, and they are what make this country strong. As Beverly made clear, the American people are reading this report closely. They are absorbing the recommendations. They are watching what you do here today and what you will do in the weeks and months ahead. And they, along with the families, will not be pleased if they see the Commission's recommendations falling by the wayside. Certainly, these hearings are a wonderful start, and I appreciate that the members of this committee have interrupted their recess to address the most serious issue facing all Americans. This type of response gives me hope that we are going to get things right for the safety and security of all of our citizens. However, Mr. Chairman, the encouragement that the families in our country receive from the timeliness of these hearings is tempered by a very real fear. The families and the American people are expecting Congress and the administration to act expediently, but without political expediency. It is important that the implementation of the Commission's recommendations occur on a timeline that is drawn to protect America, not to protect incumbents of any party, Democrat or Republican. It is vital for our nation that we avoid quick fixes that are inadequate or incomplete. We recognize that this puts you, your colleagues, and the administration in a difficult position. How can you act quickly to implement the Commission's recommendations without seeming to make political hay in the process? The solution, in my opinion, lies in the future of the 9/11 Commission itself. The families of victims have asked that the Commission be kept alive to oversee the implementation of its recommendations. This bipartisan body is uniquely qualified to monitor implementation and to reassure the American people that the process is working, that the progress being made by our elected leaders is furthering our security, and that all of the recommendations are properly implemented. Many of the 9/11 families have endorsed the Commission's recommendations as a whole. We hope that you recognize that all of the recommendations are important and all are part of a comprehensive package designed to work in concert to significantly diminish the terrorist threat facing our country. The Commission report deals with issues that go beyond intelligence czars and counterterrorism centers, issues that have led the news in recent days. The Commission has made important recommendations that deal with such critical issues as foreign policy, diplomacy, education, foreign aid, border security, terrorist financing, economic policy, and the like. I implore you to prioritize, to enact that which can be carried out immediately, but while also moving forward on recommendations requiring longer-term discussions. We, the families, challenge the members of this committee and all members of Congress to recognize that the unprecedented terrorist attacks of September 11th demands an unprecedented effort on the part of Congress that will require streamlining the committee process and exceptional coordination between the House and Senate, as well as coordination and communication with the administration. We challenge you to provide the American people with a timetable that Congress is prepared to follow to implement this report. And lastly, we challenge you to put aside turf battles and partisan rivalries and act quickly to do everything that must be done to reduce our vulnerability to another terrorist attack. In short, Mr. Chairman, the families in the entire country are looking to you and your colleagues to do your work quickly and to do it right, an awesome responsibility. You have a wonderful opportunity before you to take a leadership role, and we commend you for calling this hearing today. We also commend Congressman Shays and Congresswoman Maloney for forming a caucus for members committed to enacting all of the Commission's recommendations. Hearings like this can be important, but please demonstrate to the American public that you are serious in your efforts. Mr. Chairman, if I could take a personal moment, I was blessed on November 23rd of last year to become the mother of a beautiful little girl named Jennifer, named after the uncle she will never have the good fortune to know. The seriousness by which you take the job given to you by the 9/11 Commission will not only honor and create a positive legacy to those 3,000 souls who so tragically lost their lives on 9/11, but will determine whether Jennifer and millions of other children like her will grow up in a safe, secure, and strong America. Mr. Chairman, we implore you, please do what is required. Act smartly and act quickly. The families look forward to working very closely with you and the rest of the committee, the rest of Congress, and the administration to do what is necessary to implement the Commission's recommendations. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for some very moving and compelling testimony. I'm going to start the questioning with Mr. Waxman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank the three of you for being here and giving us your testimony. I know you speak not just for yourselves, but for others who are in the same circumstances of having suffered a loss as a result of the attack on September 11th. We've had the commission due to a great part because you've all insisted on it, and now we have those committee's recommendations. Ms. Weiner, let me start with you. Secretary Lehman said that this is not a Chinese menu, these 40 recommendations. He thought that they ought to be considered as a whole, and we ought to pass all of these recommendations because they fit together and they make it work in its totality. Do you agree with that statement?
Absolutely. I don't believe that you can cherry pick the recommendations. They all, as I mentioned in my testimony, work in concert to deal with the huge problem before us and must be dealt with as a package.
And Ms. Eckert, is it the view of the steering committee of victims of 9/11, that this be done, this legislation be done and adopted into law before we leave at the beginning of October?
Well, we think it should be done during the terms of office, that the people who are elected right now, before their term of office is over, to the extent that possible. We just think you should be productive all the way through the end of the year. And obviously, you know, the election is going to occupy some of your attention, but we don't want it to be totally diverted from what you need to do today.
Well, I would hope the fact that we have an election would be a way to drive us all together and accept these recommendations. My fear is if it gets kicked over to a lame duck session or next year, that the sense of urgency will be dissipated and that we won't have the driving force that we now have to enact the legislation in its entirety.
Yes, and it's just so important. I mean, the commission set such an incredible example of bipartisanship, and I think you know, the committee members of this room have evidenced that as well. And we need to continue in that, and we hope that legislation will be enacted before the end of the year through bipartisan cooperation.
Well, I want to join you in support of exactly that goal. Yeah. I think we ought to move forward. I was somewhat critical in questioning whether President Bush's statements yesterday reflected that same commitment. The two witnesses that we had earlier, Secretary Lehman and Senator Kerry, both thought it was a good start that the President came out and endorsed doing something. But I think that I don't in any way mean this partisan. In a partisan way, I think we've got to work together not to put something forward that looks like the Commission's recommendations, but are just as effective, in fact, the very recommendations of the Commission. I thank you very much for your testimony, and I look forward to working with you and my colleagues on both sides of the aisle to accomplish what needs to be accomplished now. It should have been done much earlier, but we need it now just as much as we ever did. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Shays.
You both make us a bit speechless. You have been fighting this battle for so long, and your eloquence is still with you. We have before us a son, Christian, a husband, Sean, and a brother, Jeff. And you give us some reality to what we need to be doing. With that in mind, I know you want this as a package, but if you told me what was the recommendation you agreed with most strongly, even if it wasn't the most important, I'd like to know that. I'd like to know what was the recommendation that spoke mostly to your heart and said yes.
To me, I think the September 11th event could have been stopped if intelligence had operated more effectively. So I do believe that, you know, there are global issues. They're going to take a long time to implement. But I think right now, because of the threat, that we really need to address integration of the intelligence stovepipes, as everybody has called. I think that's urgent.
I think that for me, it's a group of recommendations. It's the group of recommendations dealing with the global strategy and specifically what we need to do in the Muslim world and the Arab world in order to prevent the future growth of terrorism. And there was some discussion earlier about the madrasas, for example, and all the efforts that the recommendations that reflect the efforts that this government should take to provide economic stability and a better future, I think, in the Muslim world through education and through other such efforts. Those are the ones probably that are closest to my heart.
I agree with my colleagues in both of their statements. And the thing that has touched my heart the most is that Chapter 9 and the look at what happened to New York City and what happened, why 343 firefighters died, is most inadequate. The finding that the radios were not the primary cause of firefighters' death really flies in the face of so much that we know, the families know, and that has already been printed. Also, the endnotes, especially 209,
contain information that materially conflicts with what some of the family members have been told regarding specific units, regarding who heard what. We're very concerned about this, and what speaks to my heart is the need for a congressional hearings into the entire communications disaster of 9/11.
Ms. Reaganhardt, our committee has held hearings. The chairman has made sure that we've held hearings on our whole capacity to communicate and frequencies and equipment that's necessary. So we're looking at technology and so on. And he had mentioned to me that he wants us to follow up on what you have requested. But I'd like you to, so I'd like to say that we hear you.
Thank you.
But I'd like to ask you to go beyond just that area. If you could get the communication issue done, what would be the thing that then spoke to you most?
Well, certainly looking at the entire 9/11 Commission report, looking at everything in totality, what speaks to me most is that there were levels of failure in every single area of this government, of this country. There was no one held accountable or responsible for what they did. I feel, and other families of the victims feel, that their loved ones died in vain, had a wrongful death without any correction. And certainly, if these recommendations could be enacted very quickly, that would be something that speaks to me. However,
let me ask you, with my time coming to a close here,
yes.
You did not want the report to have any redacted parts to it. You wanted it to be all open. And what I want you to speak to, if you could, is the recommendation that less things be so-called intelligence classified, not available to the public. Could
yes.
you all speak to me on that issue quickly?
Yes. I'd like to say that myself, the families of the victims, and my organization is very, very shocked to hear that the 911 emergency tapes that occurred on 9/11, plus the 500 interviews that were done with the New York City firefighters immediately after 9/11, all this information, instead of being disclosed to the public, instead of being shared with the families, is going to be secreted and put into the National Archives for a minimum of 25 years. By the time that myself and other family members are able to find out what really happened to our sons and our husbands, we will really be perhaps not even in a capacity to really appreciate or understand it, or certainly not to take any action. That's one issue. But only recently, reading the commission report and reading the end notes and realizing that there is information there that contradicts what the families of the firefighters have been told, I have just recently learned that even that information is going to remain secreted and to be put in the National Archives. I am calling for full disclosure. Why on earth, with all the sensitive, declassified intelligence information that has been shared and we've gained so much from it, why on earth would the City of New York, why on earth would the 9/11 Commission want to keep any information about what happened in those buildings, what happened with the radios, what happened with the communication? Why would they want to keep that secret? I really call for full disclosure of all this information, of all the testimony, so we can really find out what happened and how can we correct it. Again, this is not about New York. There's a possibility of a massive communication failure and radio failure in any other city in this country. I want to prevent that, and I'd like full disclosure.
Thank you very much. Ms. Maloney.
I'd like to thank all the family members for their testimony and ask unanimous consent to place in the record a statement by the Family Steering Committee regarding the president.